Yeah? Okay. Did you guys make some new connections today? Get inspired? Perfect. So our next road talk is going to focus on how to reduce your business risks on payroll management. It'll be provided by John Paul Moutinho, and he's the senior manager of National Bank, a service provider. So they actually provide Netherite, which is a payroll services. So I mentioned before that when you're starting up a business, once you've incorporated, you use an accounting system to get your books in check, but it's very important to get a payroll system in place. You don't have to deal with all that burden right after. When you're pitching to investors, they'll also not only ask you if you have your books in place, but if you have a payroll management in check. So we've been using actually a payroll system from the very beginning, and Netherite is a state-of-the-art solution. It's really easy to set up and use, and a human can do it better than a system, so you might as well use the best one, which is Netherite. So without further ado, I'm going to get John Paul to take the floor and give you some tips on payroll management. So thank you, and warm welcome to John Paul.
Thank you, Lana. Hey, folks. Hope you're all doing well. Thanks for the lovely intro. So my name is John Paul Moutinho. I work for the National Bank, Senior Manager, Payroll, Human Resources. Been in the field of human capital management now since 1997. And today we're going to look at the importance of paying your people well. When it comes to human capital management, there's a lot of different elements that you have to consider. And as business drivers, which I want to congratulate you because we need people like you in this country, there's important elements that you have to think of from the onset and not things that allow you to come back later on thinking that you can think about it later. So we're going to start now. Yep. Thank you, my dear. So how does this all come to fruition? At one point, you guys had an idea. And that idea you brainstormed, you thought about, and that idea led to a plan. And that plan obviously is something that you guys wanted to bring to the next level because the idea was great. And then at one point you take action. So we can see that you thought, you documented, and then at one point you had to get dollars to make this live. And then once it took life, you probably had some brick and mortar to package everything all together. So everything is going well. You're on the right track, business is taking shape and form. And at one point, you're going to realize that you can't do everything by yourself. Starting a business, where to start? What does the government expect from you? Obviously, when you're starting a business, there's a lot of intangibles that you have to take into consideration. And one of them is laws. And in Canada, we have enough of them. What does the government expect for anybody who's going into business? Whether you have employees or not, you're expected to have an established pay frequency, even if you're just the owner-operator. You have to request your source deduction numbers because the idea there is at one point you're going to have employees. That's the thought that they have. So you're going to have federal and provincial remittance numbers. And then you have to decide how you're going to get paid. Are you going to be an employee of your company or are you going to be strictly living on dividends? There are benefits and advantages to both. We're not necessarily going to get into that today, but this is where your accountant and your lawyer come into play. And I think a hybrid combination of both can be very interesting for all business owners. So business owner remuneration, which option is right for my business? So I'll revert back to your lawyer and your accountant, but I will share with you certain thoughts and ideas that allow you to think and prepare for that meeting with your accountant and your lawyer. We all know that when the timer starts, it goes fast. An owner-manager who chooses to be paid in the form of a salary, bonus, or management fees is, in effect, an employee of the business. So you're entitled to benefits that an employee in Canada are entitled to. Receiving a dividend, on the other hand, means an owner-manager is treated as a shareholder of his business, and that brings you other advantages more on the fiscal side. A combination of both gives you access to benefits on both sides. However, categorizing the way one chooses to take remuneration from a business is not the end of the matter for an owner-manager. There's other elements that you have to consider. The CRA may simply reverse the choice made by owner-manager and find that a dividend is actually a salary or vice versa. So the message we're trying to share with you today is that when you start thinking what's best for you without necessarily looking into the laws that govern it, can be very costly for you. Over the past 7 to 10 years, the provincial and federal agencies have changed their approach when it comes to tax collection. At one point, they were more of cost centers. Today, they're more profit centers. So they aggressively look to see and look for the entities that are not respecting the laws to make sure that they're collecting and respecting a maximum of taxes that you're entitled or that you're due to pay. So it's important that you have the right guidelines from the onset. Salary, bonus, or management fees demonstrate that the owner manager has provided services for a requisite value. So if you start drawing these elements, you have to be able to justify why you're drawing these elements. Dividends paid to an owner manager. Transaction must be documented as a dividend resolution and entered into the company's record book. By the way, the definitions that I'm showing you here today are available on CRA and Services Canada website, so you can access that. Determining how to withdraw remuneration from a business while receiving the most advantageous tax benefits is a decision best made in conjunction with your accountant, because there are elements where you're going to favor being a hybrid of a dividend taker as well as an employee. But how much salary do you draw versus how much dividend do you draw comes into play. So you need to know certain elements, like what are your maximum coverages if you're an employee, to determine how much you're going to draw a salary versus the dividends you're going to take at the end of the year. This is where your accountant can say, okay, we'll draw a salary, but this is the amount you should cap yourself out at and maximize your dividends on the other side. At one point, you're going to realize that you can't do this all alone. You're going to need help. You had a great idea. You put it to the table, you have brick and mortar, you're getting investing. Well, human capital is a very big element in realizing your idea. So what's going to happen is you're going to want to hire your first employee. But then you're going to think, do I hire an employee or do I hire a contractor? If I hire an employee, that has one impact. If I hire a contract, there's another impact. On the contractor side, there's a lot of fiscal advantages that are interesting for you, and there's also less obligation toward that that individual. On the employee side, there is more taxes and there are obligations toward that employee. However, the decision whether it's an employee or a contract doesn't necessarily go according to what you believe you're doing or your opinion. And this is where most organizations or startups get in trouble, is they believe they're hiring a contractor. However, the way they're treating that contractor is not really a contractor, it's an employee. And when you're hiring a contractor and you're signing a contract that hopefully was endorsed by your accountant or your lawyer, everything is fine when you're signing that contract. It's like a relationship. Everything's great at the beginning. The trouble starts when there's a separation. That's when people start to realize that, hey, maybe this wasn't the right way. And this is where things can get very costly for you and risky if you didn't follow the guidelines that are set forth. For example, some general concepts. The salaried employee can contact the Employment Standards Commission if he feels he's subjected to unfair conditions. The contractual can't. The contractual is being processed as an entity and not as a human being because he's not an employee. The salaried employee represents a fiscal burden for the employer, not the contractual. When you're a contractual, you agree on a certain amount and a duration of the contract, you pay those amounts and it stops there. The salaried employee has a loyalty responsibility to his employee, established by law. Not the contractual. That means the employee who you hired could only work for you. The contractual, technically, according to laws, can work for more than one provider. The contractual employee is considered as an independent self-employed entrepreneur, not the salaried. Because of his status, the contractual or self-employed employee benefits from different tax treatment. And this is probably the most popular one as to why people point toward contract employees versus versus contractors. Now, employee versus contractors, establishing the status. How do you know if it's going to be an employee or a contractor? The first question is very simple, control. As an employee, I must report to your office or report to a fixed work schedule determined by you. The contractor will work for you according to his mandate when he can, when he feels he has to, based on a deliverable date. The employee has to report on a fixed schedule. So the first thing you should ask yourself when you're looking at an employee or a contractor, are you controlling his time or he's controlling his time? It has nothing to do with the deliverable at the end of the line. It has to do with who's controlling the time of the resource. Tools and equipment. If you're providing a smartphone, laptop, other material for him to produce his work, well then, typically contractors have their own tools. They have their own materials. Now, if you're providing this, you're approaching more the relationship of an employer-employee. Financial risks. Who's assuming the financial risk when it comes to an employee versus a contractee? An employee, when you're paying him, he's going to be a full-time employee. There's going to be obligations on your part. On a contractual basis, he has a fixed term to that contract. When you end, the financial engagement is over. Responsibility for investment and management, opportunity for profit or not, are other elements that you must consider when you're looking at employee to contractor. you decide that based on the assessment that you're going toward the, you're going to go toward the employee route. You're going to be looking at hiring someone. So when you hire someone, it's all fun at the beginning, but there's a lot of compliance. The troubles begin. Payroll management does not end once the checks are signed. There's a lot more to paying a person in Canada than one can imagine. These are some of the elements that you will be faced as when you're an employer. Now, certain things like signing a check are very easy, but getting to the amount on that check is something that's a challenge. Looking at different elements in terms of tax savings accounts, WCB payments, government remittances, records of employment. I don't know if anyone here has ever tried to do a record of employment for an employee that has been terminated. It's something that can be very complicated, and believe it or not, punishable by imprisonment if it's deemed that there was some foul play. Because obviously you're engaging everything that has to do with the employment services in Canada in terms of insurable hours and payments that you'll receive if you lose your job. So, for example, should an employee be working for you and he stopped working for a month, completing this record of employment becomes a challenge because you need to report to the very fine detail in terms of hours and dollars what the employee did. An incorrection or a mistake on that statement to the government and to the employee has a lot of collateral damage.
Against the law or not?
Pardon me. Can you reform?
If someone have been working for a company for about 5 years
as an employee,
and then they on the record of employment mark down you as the annual contract. Mm-hmm. Without the guy does not sign any contract at all, is the employer against the law?
Well, as an employer, you can have a contract, and now I don't know the conditions of the record of employment that was issued to the person. I don't know if it was you or where it was issued to, but his obligation is to identify all of the insurable hours and earnings on that contract and to identify the reason for termination, and it has to be deemedly signed by the organization that did that. Now, in your case, I cannot answer, based on what you're telling me, if they did wrong or they did right.
Mm-hmm. Because without signing any contract or no signing any contract.
Well, you can terminate an employee in Canada based on the Labor Commission standards. So depending on the number of years worked, they will issue to you an amount based on a 4 or 6 or 8%, depending on certain conditions of your remuneration. If he respected those guidelines, he's fine, as long as he gives you due notice. Those due notice can range from 2 to 3 to 4, 6 weeks, depending on what the Labor Commission standards are or the contract that you may have signed as an employee. Compliance. When it comes to processing payroll in Canada, there are many laws touching a payroll. Actually, to be quite frank with you, there are 190 of them. There are 190 laws. So if you have someone that you bring onto payroll and you're paying him a couple of $1,000 every 2 weeks, there are 190 laws you must respect to make sure he gets a right and due net payment. And that goes from how you calculate to what's on the earning statement. Now, obviously, your core specialty is not knowing those 190 laws. And if you try investing your time into that, you probably will learn. But is that where you want to be putting your energies when you're starting off your business? For example, vacation, statutory holidays. Every province in Canada has different regulations when it comes to paying people for time off based on different holidays. Christmas pay, Easter pay, every province is going to process it differently. So if you have employees that are due multi-province, for example, you've hired some key resources that are in Quebec. Quebec alone has 30 specific rules to itself. Your obligation, even though that you're paying the person from Vancouver, is to respect the fact that the employee is in Quebec and pay according to those laws in Quebec. Do you want to invest your time knowing how to calculate statutory or bank holidays in different provinces in Canada?
Contractual employees.
It applies to an employee.
Okay.
However, an employee can sign a contract with a duration of time. The contractor is an entity. You agree on a transaction. You will deliver this, in exchange I will pay you that, and these are the T's and C's. The employee can have a contract, but it's the Labor Commission that's going to preside over that, even though you have a contract with them. So we spoke about the record of employment and other elements that touch compliance in Canada when it comes to payroll. So think of every time that there's a new budget, every time a new political power party goes into power, they want to have an impact. They're going to change laws around health, change laws about how people get paid. and they give you about 60 days to incorporate that into your payment methods with your employees. Are you agile? Are you governing that risk? Are you mitigating that risk? Should you be mitigating that risk when you should be focusing on your business? Most companies don't. They leave that aside and they say, I'll get to it later. The problem is that's where it starts to get very expensive. Because the government, whether it's provincial or federal, once they deem that there's a mistake, they're going to backtrack to the date that they believe is the right date. And you will owe those monies plus interest since then. And this is where it can be very crippling to an organization who's starting off. Privacy. Why would privacy come into play? Well, you're hiring a person. That person is giving you what? His name, his social insurance number, his date of birth, his next of kin, his address, his telephone number. He's giving you everything that someone would need for identity theft. Now, you're collecting that data on behalf of your employee. What are you doing to secure that information? In Canada, we have something called the PEPETA Act. The PEPETA Act is what governs all private, confidential information of every citizen in Canada. It's about this thick. It's your obligation as an employer to know what's in there, to make sure that you're not making a mistake in managing that personal information. Now, the government of Canada says if you're paying someone, you have to archive information for 7 years. 7 years of payroll registers. That's the law. So ignorance is not an option. I didn't know is not an option. It gets very expensive when you say, I don't know. So that means you have to govern 7 years of information. Where are you protecting that information? Are you keeping it in a box, in an office? Are you keeping it on a laptop, on a server, on a backup drive? Right? How are you protecting that information? And again, should you be investing a lot of money into that in protecting that information? Maybe yes, maybe no, but it's something that you have to do. And there's a lot of identity theft in North America. I mean, I don't need to educate you guys. We're in the tech world here, and we all know that today there's very many savvy ways and many different types of ways of stealing information. Business risks. When we talk about business risks, it's very simple. Continuity. So you're paying your person. You decide that you're going to pay your two or three or four employees, and you're going to buy a solution, or you're going to do it yourself. Well, how do you ensure that you have redundancy there? How do you ensure that you have a backup plan? Because paying your employee becomes very key to his mobilization towards you. At one point in your lives, you have all been an employee at one stage. I've been an employee. I am an employee today. And I can tell you one thing. The minute there's a mistake on my paycheck, the first thing I do is I wonder why there's a mistake on my paycheck, even though I'm working on an important element. Why? Because I know through my checking account, there's going to be my mortgage payment, there's going to be this payment, that payment. So when you're paying your employees, how are you ensuring that they're getting paid? So if your server is to crash, if your laptop is to disappear, or the person who's managing that disappears because they're off, they're sick, or they quit, does that mean the employee is not entitled to get paid on Thursday? The minute you start making a mistake on your employee's payroll, I can guarantee you his mobilization towards you and his perception toward you will change. He will think, maybe there's money problems here. Or he's not organized, he's all over the place. It's a question of perception, people by people, right? So if you can't even pay me properly, how should I work fully mobilized for you? And we've all been employees. And most people maybe won't admit it, but the first thing we look at is, what does my check say and did the right amount go through? And if not, and if there's missing a couple of $100, before I'm finishing that email, that report, that coding language, or whatever I'm working on, I'm calling payroll, trying to track the owner to say, hey, there's a couple $100 missing on my payroll. What's going on? I got bills going through my account. You want to manage that? Is that a legitimate risk that you should be managing?
How many months in Canada does the employee can sue the employer? He do not give you the right amount of the paycheck, 2 months or 3 months?
Well, it's not just a question of suing right away, because employers do have time to correct their mistakes. It can't be that he makes a mistake for $100 and you sue him. You have to give him reasonable time to fix that problem. And if he doesn't fix that problem, you go to the Labor Commissions Board and you present your case. Then you engage in a process. It's not a question of this much. It's not a fixed law.
What's the duration or time for them to fix the mistake of their paycheck?
What you're going to be reading on the Services Canada website is a reasonable time frame. So it's going to be days and weeks. Yeah, because it depends on every organization, depending on the situation and the nature of the error. There's not 48 hours, 72 hours, but he has to take charge immediately and provide an option or a solution for you. So do a manual check or make arrangements with you to absorb some debt. Because if you don't pay someone on time and his mortgage payment goes through and there's no funds in the account, whose fault is it? Well, technically, it's the fault of the person who has the mortgage. So that person, your employee towards his bank, is engaged. But if the money doesn't go into his account, who's he turning to? Well, you guys didn't pay me on time. We have a contract. So then you see where it goes. It gets very, very complicated. So when we talk about business continuity, it's making sure that we have backups in terms of who's doing it, the machines that are doing it, the servers that are running it. And this is where it gets expensive. Yes?
When you outsource that service, I mean the payroll service, do you outsource as well the risk? I mean, the company will be anyway in charge or responsible of the same thing.
You're mitigating that heavily, though, because we put forth, and I'll explain it maybe later towards the end of the presentation when I get to that, but we mitigate that risk heavily because we put in place protocol that don't let that happen. So you will know well beforehand that you're jeopardizing yourself before it actually happens. Whereas if you do it yourself, typically people wait to the last minute and put themselves in predicaments where they're managing in a reactive fashion instead of a proactive fashion. And I'll touch on it again at the end of the presentation when we go into the specific details. So again, when you talk about business processing and continuity, it's your equipment, it's your data, and it's also your resources. At this stage, you're growing, you're small. But as you grow, because you're going to have successful businesses, you will have more equipment. You will have to archive your data for 7 years. You will have to have people probably managing this. And you can't always do this yourself manually and invest that time doing that. Financial risks, employer, remittances. As you know, when you hire someone, 35 to 40% of his wages go to tax collection, to our social programs in Canada. It's your obligation to pay those on time and pay those accordingly. How do you ensure that you're mitigating that risk properly? How are you making sure that you're remitting that money on time and you're remitting it accurately? So if you make a mistake in your calculation because you're doing it on your own and you remit and then you get audited, and they see that you made a mistake, well, they backtrack to the first payment that you owed and they tack on the interest from there. Or if, let's say, you pay late, 10% of the amount that you did not deduct will be paid as a penalty first time. Then it jumps up to 20%. And when I tell you that ignorance, or I did not know, or please forgive me, give me a chance, it does not work with the governments anymore. You have an obligation as an employer to pay on time, respect the amounts that you have to pay, and pay them accordingly. When you look at 10 or 20% of gross wages, and in the tech world, the average wages are kind of high, that can be stiff penalties and it can hurt your cash flow and your liquidity. So the major risks when it comes to paying people or managing payroll as an entrepreneur or a company are compliance, what touches laws, privacy, what's sensitive, protecting the data, business risk, continuity, and financial risks, making sure you respect the laws and the calculations. Because when we talk about financial, it's not just the federal provincial remittance. It's what you calculate. It's the health boards that you're remitting to. It's the unemployment insurance remittance that you have to remit to. There's a whole bunch of different remittances that you as an employer are obliged to do. And again, an omission based on ignorance is not a reason. Accurate and timely payroll is invaluable for employee loyalty. We know it, we live it, you've been employees at one stage. So this is something that if you want to keep your people mobilized on a simple task, well, the best way is to do it accurately. And payroll, unfortunately, is probably going to be your first or second largest expense. Why? Because it's your human capital. This very human capital that's going to drive and power the success of the idea you had at the beginning. So they deserve to be paid and invested and managed properly. They're the ones that are going to bring your business to the next level. So is payroll your field of expertise? For most small, medium businesses in Canada, it's not. What are your options? This is where it gets interesting. Of course, you guys are all from the tech world, so chances are you're very good in your soft skills. You're very good at coding and developing. You can always create your own payroll solution on Excel. There you go. You can invest maybe a couple of thousand hours of your time and create your own payroll. Is that where you should be investing your time? And then, of course, when there's new governments and they change the laws, you have to make sure that you go there into your spreadsheet and change the calculations for the new law that just came in a couple of months ago, and you got 60 days to do it. And by the way, I hope there's no virus in here, but chances are you've backed it up on a server somewhere, hopefully. So you see where I'm going? This option is a very risky option. Your accountant, that's a great option. It's a luxury. It's a luxurious option. Accountants will provide that service with a big smile. However, the best example for me to explain to you the accountant example, to make it very easy for you to understand, is using your accountant to process your payroll is probably the same thing as using a chef in a high-class restaurant to wash the dishes. Would you do that? When you go to a high-class restaurant and you have the chef there, you want him to make you creative culinary dishes. You don't want him washing the pots and pans in the back. But it's important those pots and pans are clean because you eat on them, correct? Right. So having the accountant process your payroll, which is very important, is the same correlation as that. Therefore, your accountant should be doing work for you that touches on financial performance of your company, on job distribution, performance, cost performance of your different projects, and cash flow statements that really bring value in terms of strategic knowledge to you, and not processing your payroll. But it is a very expensive option. Or you could purchase your own off-the-shelf accounting solution, which is interesting. However, you're not mitigating all the risks. You still have to make sure that there's backup plans. You still have to make sure that you're paying your people on time. This is just going to calculate A to B. All of the other components that come into play, you're responsible for them. It becomes a risk that you must mitigate. There is another option. That other option, use the Payroll Service Bureau. Organizations in Canada exist, and there's about 4 to 5 top-tier organizations in Canada that process payroll. The service bureau solutions that are geared to the small, medium market like yourself, that are very cost-effective, and in most cases, clients are surprised to see what it costs to use a payroll service bureau that is going to help you mitigate all those risks. It's going to help you save time so you can focus on your core business. Here are some of the tasks that are going to eat up your time when you start processing payroll. And this is not coming from our opinion. This is coming from our 15,000 clients. Payroll entry, managing, entering the data, your general ledger, because you have to report into your accounting ledger what your journal entries are for payroll, calculating your time banks, vacation banks, and how you track those banks, because remember, people are entitled to vacation in Canada. What are you paying them at? How are you tracking it? And more times than not, if there's a mistake, it's not the employee's fault, it's the employer's fault. Looking for legal information. Someone decides to leave, he quits. What do you owe him? What are you going to do? Who are you going to call? What's your approach? Call the accountant. Great option. Timer starts. I don't know. But then you're going to say, yeah, but he pays me a monthly fee and I get everything. No, he gives you a monthly fee for a certain amount of hours. And if you start passing those hours, it becomes a paying fee. Reduce time. Get access to experts. So when you use a payroll service bureau, you can call and say, hey, I have a termination pay. Hey, I have someone going on mat leave. Hey, I have a bonus that I want to pay. What do the laws say? How do I go about it? Can you provide some guidance? We will never tell you what to do. We will just tell you what the government says to do. And then you have the option to respect that and go according to the different needs that you have in your business. But the guidance is there and it's a phone call away. The most complex tasks in processing payroll. Everyone forgets about this one, but it's very popular. T4s, Relevé 1s, employer summaries. I'll do it myself. Mm-hmm. What happens if you report a T4 to an employee and it's inaccurate? And he does his statements at the end of the year. And instead of getting a refund, he has to pay. Or better yet, instead of getting a refund, the opposite. You're impacting his net line. Why? Because there was something that was done incorrectly. How are you in mitigating the risk that you're calculating T4s and Relevé 1s and employer summaries properly? Time banks, records of employments, looking for legal information. This is what most small, medium businesses spend their time on when they're processing payroll. This means you will be spending your time on doing this if you're doing it yourself as well. The average client of payroll service bureaus in Canada is between 1 and 20 employees. Between 1 and 20 employees. It's not geared for the large organizations. It's geared for the small organizations. Mitigating your risks. I touched on that earlier on. There's 4 major axes that you have to mitigate. And Lana touched on it earlier on. When you're going for capital or you're looking for finance, you're speaking to venture capitals, they're going to ask you about your business, but they're also going to ask you, because they're very smart, because they know that there's something that's called priority credits, which are essentially the money you owe the government. They know that before they get paid, the government gets paid, and they're going to ask you, how are you managing your payroll? And if you say, well, I want to save money, you know, the first couple of years, I'm paying attention, so I'm doing it myself. That's not the answer they want to hear. They want to know if they're lending you money, that they're protected and they're safe. So by you doing it yourself, you're actually making the risk greater on their side. They want to see that you're locking up this. You're making sure that the federal and provincial governments are taken care of and your employees are being paid properly. So, how can we help you? Well, at the National Bank, we have a partner called Nethris. Nethris is a payroll service bureau, Canadian-born, based in Canada. 13,000 clients across the country, over 40 years of experience. Our clients are 99.3% satisfied. Our average client stays with us about 10 years, and we're the only service bureau payroll provider in Canada that is ISO certified. That means our service levels are very, very strong. Our response times are very, very strong. So there is a solution for you. And as a business driver, as an employer, as an entrepreneur, of course I would like for you to see what we have to offer. But first and foremost, I would ask you to consider outsourcing your payroll to a payroll service bureau as the first recommendation. That's the most important element that I would share with you. With us, yes, of course, we would love to have you as clients. But more importantly, for your business, outsource that element. You don't need that headache. And it's a lot more accessible than you believe. Nethris is a CGI-owned company. CGI is a very large IT firm, probably the fourth largest in the world right now. And they're the ones who back up our system. So could you imagine an IT firm like CGI? Our infrastructure on the IT side is fully redundant and capable of having disaster recovery plans and dealing with situations where from 1 minute to the other, we're managing things in real time where you, the client, won't even realize there was a disaster and you can process your payroll. Can you do the same when you're doing it internally? Some people can, but at a cost. That cost is either time or money. Is that where you want to focus your time and your money? So I want to thank you for your time. Appreciate it very much. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Thank you for the presentation. May I know what is a head office?
The head office of CGI, actually, their head office is based in Montreal, but they have offices all over Canada.
Oh, I see.
So our payroll solutions, if you're asking about the payroll operations, there's two major offices, Toronto and Quebec. All solutions are cloud-based, so you don't have to have brick and mortar in every province. Everything is done online, toll-free lines, and the support hours cover all time ranges in Canada. So to make the services accessible, we avoid having brick and mortar in every province.
And one more question. Is your company in stock market yet?
Pardon?
In stock market.
Absolutely. So that's a very good question. I'm happy you asked that. There's tier one, tier two, tier three, tier four suppliers. There's a lot of new pop-up shops trying to do payroll as well. However, when it comes to a payroll service bureau, we come and debit the money in your account. And we debit the money that we're going to pay this gentleman and the money we're going to remit to the governments. So we debit in your account, we hold that money and pay agencies when we have to and pay the people when we have to. However, in this case, it's the National Bank and CGI, two public billion-dollar companies that are doing it. When you're dealing with smaller firms, private firms, you want to make sure that your money is safe.
We have a question here.
Yep.
So how much do you charge for your services? And also, when it comes to how does it work? I mean, as an employer, we pass in the information of employees to you, and you can just automatically every month.
It's easier than Facebook. That's how easy it is. You go online, you enter your employee data, or we can do it for you, and then you just enter the amount you pay them, and you process the information. How much does it cost? It's a very good question. How many employees do you have?
Five?
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's our average. It's the average we have in our clients. Before I answer your question, can you guesstimate what do you think it would cost to have a payroll service that would manage everything for you end to end and do your net deposits in the accounts?
Per person or
in total? Give me a number that you
annually?
Find reasonable. Per pay. What do you pay your employees?
I would say around 1,000, 1,500. I guess I haven't used your system, but...
So you have five. When do you pay? You pay your employees every 2 weeks?
Yes.
Every 2 weeks? Yeah. Okay. And you think it would cost you $1,000 every 2 weeks to use the service? Is that what you're talking
about? No, I was talking about annually.
Annually. So what do you think per pay? What does that break down to?
Divided by 26, so it's like $20.
So we're around there. You're looking at about $25 to $30. And
per
that includes...
Per pay?
For everything. $30 for all of your five employees. And that includes your banking fees. So when you're doing it yourself today, you're doing all the investing the time and calculating it yourself. Then you're signing checks, which you purchased. And then those checks get cashed in and you have another service fee. Well, all those fees disappear. It's included in that $30. And if you annualize that, $1,000 or $1,100, what's your gross annual payroll for 5 people? What are we looking at? In the couple hundred thousand dollars range? Yeah. Right. Is it reasonable to spend $1,000 to properly pay your people?
Of course. I mean, the time worth more than that.
Think of that. You're managing payroll of a couple hundred thousand dollars, and you're not going to spend $1,000 to make sure you pay them properly and you respect the laws. Is it strategic or not? That's the idea.
Yeah.
Thanks for your question. Yes?
Did you say $30? Five?
Yeah, roughly.
5 employees per month?
No, per pay period. Pre-established pay, so by either weekly, bi-weekly, semi-monthly, or monthly. Oh. So if you pay monthly, it's going to be $30 per month. If you pay bi-weekly, it's going to be $30 every 2 weeks.
Okay.
I wouldn't advise paying your employees monthly. We're not in Europe yet. It's tough. Okay. It's hard on the budgeting side. But the norm in Canada is every 2 weeks or bi-monthly.
Okay.
Thanks. Executive payrolls are saved for monthly reasons, or done on a monthly basis, I should say. It's very accessible as a service.
So we open an account, you let's go bank?
You don't have to. Thank you for your question. You don't have to be a client of the National Bank to use the service. We have 13,000 clients. I would say close to 35% of them are not National Bank clients. We sell the service across Canada. So we have clients of the Royal Bank, CIBC, TD, BMO, credit unions. Not a problem. But I appreciate you mentioning that. Yes?
Okay, well, I know that your company is strong enough because it's two government-based companies supporting. But what about the other companies that you mentioned that are your competitors? What happened if, I'd say, I outsource their services with one of those and they go out of business? What happened with the 7 years?
Are you talking about the tier ones, the tier twos, tier threes?
Yeah, whatever, all the...
Well, if you're talking about the tier ones, of the tier ones, most of them are traded publicly. And your money is 99% safe. But when you go into the mom and pop shops, that's where it gets a little bit trickier. So I can't speak for those, but I can speak for the large players in the market like we are. Your money is safe with them. They're not gonna burn their brand and their reputation and their billion-dollar companies for a small payroll. So that your money is secure with them. Now, if you were to ask me, John, why would we look at your Nethra service versus the other markets in the tier ones? Well, we're the best bang for the buck, and our service levels are guaranteed and backed by an ISO certification. Most of our clients save 20 to 30% when they switch to us. So that's the benefit. You're welcome. Thanks again. Oh, one more question.
Sorry. Is there any relation between you and the lawyer? I mean, the company's lawyer.
So we don't have power of attorney over your business, right? So if you have a lawyer, we can speak to him if you give us the power to do so. We're not the law. We just make sure that we interpret the law and we share to you what the best practices are. So, for example, if you were to ask us advice, we will share to you what the advice is. What you decide to do, based on what we tell you, comes back to you, the client. We're just the service that we provide. Now, if you want us to speak to your lawyer, we can speak to your lawyer, like we speak to accountants. We have many clients where they empower their lawyers or their accountants to speak with us, and we do that, so long as they can act on your behalf and they have a power of attorney to do so, right? In the service that we're talking about now, well, we're limited to human capital management services only. So payroll, human resources, recruiting, and stuff like that. But today we spoke about payroll. Thanks again for your time. Much appreciated. And I wish you guys all the best of luck. And I thank you for your business and listening.
Thank you so much, Jean-Paul.
Can I get a shot of you posed by the, just in front of the sign?
With or without Lana?
So did you guys learn something new about payroll? Some traps about payroll? You need money? Okay, so our next road talk will be provided by Hussein Halak that you heard speak before the lunch break. He'll be talking to you about the three colossal mistakes entrepreneurs make when fundraising. So without further ado, please let's give him a big round of applause. And Hussein, take it away.
Thank you, guys.
Oh, and when you do Q&A, just please raise your hand and we'll pass the mic. It's better for the people that are listening with the live stream to hear you.
Hello, okay, it works. I don't know if I need it, I'm usually loud. All right, guys, so the three colossal mistakes that entrepreneurs make when they're fundraising. So I wanna start by telling you a story, a startup story. Okay, I think in the back, some of you may not be seeing this. I'm just gonna move it. Okay, cool. So, you get that billion-dollar idea, right? So, I have a billion-dollar idea. You sit with some of your friends. This is awesome, okay? You gotta do it. So, you gather around a little, some people, and you start, you say, okay, I'm just gonna do this. And then I do some investor pitches. And of course, they're going to agree with me. They're going to love everything I'm going to say. And then a lot of money will come my way. Okay? Anybody had this story happen to them? It's a fairy tale. So let me tell you about a real startup story. Okay, first of all, it's a lot of sleepless nights. Then most everyone will disagree with you. Some will tell you even this idea is stupid, you're stupid, whatever you said, like depending on how honest they want them to be or how mean. And you're gonna be crushed for money before you get money. I don't know if you know, but the Airbnb guys, they sold cereal in the first year to fund their business. There is a lot of money in the startup investment world. So in 2014, $47 billion were invested. But they were invested only in 3,600 deals. Okay? So while the number sounds really big, but there's not a lot of deals there. And in the angel world, in the tech world, only $1.33 billion were invested. And crowdfunding has been $2.3 billion, more than the angel money invested. So this idea that there's a lot of money out there, investors are just waiting for me to give me money, is not true. There's over 70,000 startups, tech startups, that are started every year in North America. I think that's only the US even. Not even, doesn't include Canada. 70,000 every year. So just like we said, if you think you're the only one and your idea is unique, it probably isn't. And that's part of a pool of 600,000 startups that are considered not tech. That's every year added to the ecosystem. 90% of those will fail, and only 0.0000, whatever, so less than 5% of a percent will get funding. So this is the reality. So there is not a lot out there. So of course the question is for you, why do you want to do this as an entrepreneur? But also, it's very important, do you agree it's very important to avoid mistakes since there's very little out there, right? That's why these mistakes don't just become simple mistakes, they're colossal mistakes. So what are some of these mistakes? Now, I'm not going to talk about the mistakes you make in the pitch or when you're investors. I'm going to talk about mistakes that start the moment you start your startup. So the first mistake, seeking investment as a lifeline. What does that really mean? It means that you seek investment when it's very late. Now you need the money, now you go out and get investment. Very big mistake. Very big mistake. Or you already have a limited network. A lot of those entrepreneurs that are out there are developers, are product specialists or professionals. They are not used to networking. They don't have a big network. They probably have 100 friends or like 200 connections on LinkedIn. So now you want to go out and bring investment, you have to have a wide network. You have to know people. So you cannot have a limited network. And the last thing is what I've seen a lot is entitlement mentality. I have a great startup. You should fund me. What do you mean you're not going to give me money? Are you an idiot? This is the next Uber for whatever, or the next Facebook for whatever, you know? And you should give me your money. Never works. This is one of the biggest mistakes entrepreneurs make. So I want to quote Anita, who's founded The Body Shop. Nobody talks of entrepreneurship as survival, but that's exactly what it is. So you need to have a survival mentality. How do you survive? By preparing as an entrepreneur. So if that's the mistake, what do you do to avoid this mistake? Okay, I'm not just going to point the mistakes. I want to point what you need to do. So first of all, start early. How early? Very early. The moment you say, hey, I think this is a good idea, start talking to people. Start talking to investors. And I don't mean start pitching. That's wrong, obviously, because don't pitch for money when you're still early to money. But start talking to investors. Start taking their advice. Start asking them, what should I do? Who should I talk to? Where do I network? Because they're happy to help you. They want you to grow to become a fundable company. So start early. Do those coffees. Meet those people. When I first landed in Vancouver 2 years ago, I didn't know anybody. I knew two people in Vancouver. And by chance, because I knew them in Dubai, and I found out when I came here that they moved to Vancouver. I didn't know they moved. I had 2,000 people on my LinkedIn, but they were all in Dubai. Some of you might think, oh, that's a lot. So if you think that's a lot, first of all, I started like trying to get a job. Obviously, that's what my wife told me. It's like, get a job. I'm an entrepreneur. No, we need a job. You need to pay for the bills. So I went.
How do you categorize your 2,000 people?
I don't categorize them because they were like a multiple of people in Dubai. But what happened is I went to like develop my resume and everything, and I applied for 200 jobs. Obviously, I didn't get anything. I got one lousy interview, and they said, this doesn't work. So my mentality was like, okay, what am I good for? I'm good at networking. So I spend 1 month working my LinkedIn profile, because that's my website as a person, as the startup of me. And I networked with everyone to the point I got 5 job offers, and I was more connected in the tech community than anybody else in Vancouver. I now have 7,000 people. 5,000 of those are all in Vancouver in North America. You can name any CEO, any entrepreneur, any investor. I'll be connected probably with them. And I wouldn't know, maybe.
Which one? You said the LinkedIn or?
LinkedIn. So this is LinkedIn I did. Twitter, social, Facebook, forget about them. In regards to connecting with people professionally, LinkedIn is the startup of you. So even if you don't know the name of your startup, even if you don't know what you're going to do, if this is going to be the startup, start networking and building your network. So network. Meet people. Go out there. And networking is not about adding people. So the thing is, like, a lot of people get that, say, yeah, I need to add people. No, you need to give value. Networking is not about, I don't boast, 7,000 people. I add value. So if you are on my LinkedIn, you always get articles, you always get posts that actually adds value to you. I'm not spamming people, telling them, hey, look how great I am. I'm inviting them to good stuff. So people who follow me, even people who follow me on Facebook, they say, you post a lot, but you know, I see all of what you post. I like what you post. And how do you find those interesting stuff? So I spend a lot of time adding value to people. And I just got today from someone here at the conference who came and asked me, he said, thank you for guiding us to this new tool. Thank you for letting me know. So even when I'm on the phone with someone and they ask me, or are we talking about something, and say, have you tried this? Have you tested it? So going out there and giving value will make you more known. Will get people to want to be around you, and they say thank you for that. And that's what you want to do. You want to go out when you network. You know, those investors are people too. They're not just people walking around with stacks of money. So they have problems, they have things they deal with. They need help in certain things. Like one of the things that investors come to me for, can you help us find good companies to invest in? So when you introduce them to people, after you vet them, you know you help them a lot because they go through a lot of shitty pitches and they waste a lot of time. So there's many ways you can add value and network when you start, and even your startup is not ready. By the time it's ready, you have the network, you have the knowledge, you know people, and they've seen you develop, that they're ready to invest in you, that you're friends more. Yes?
But wouldn't it be challenging for people like yourself? You always build great content to share it with people, but what's the percentage that, you know, per week, how much time do you spend on like creating and sharing content, right? It would be challenging for, how do you do it? How do you like balance this?
The quick tips is I actually spend weekends. I don't spend during the week. I'm super busy. I can't actually spend time on social media posting content. But what I do, I use a tool called Buffer. Okay, amazing tool. Of course, I love Hootsuite. They're a Vancouver company. But Buffer is so much easier for posting. So Hootsuite is amazing for like a monitoring and a complete social media tool. But Buffer is a great tool for posting and easy. So what I do is I research a lot of content. In my work, I research and read a lot. So while researching and reading a lot, I add it on Buffer. So it adds on. So if I stop today posting, it will keep on going for another 2 months. And most of the content that I read and share is timeless. I don't share news. Unless there's a certain news, I share it in the moment. But everything else I share is timeless. So things that you can do and you can use in the areas of my expertise that I'm reading all the time and I'm coming across all the time. So I use that as part of, I make it part of my day. I can't have time like, okay, now it's time for social media. Now it's time for this. Now it's time for this. So as part of my day, I do that and I keep adding. It's kind of like I find something good and I add it on the side. And it happens to be Buffer and it goes in certain times that I select in the day. So that's one way I do it. And the big thing is I look at networks. A lot of people are hesitant when I talk about LinkedIn or other networks. I look at networks as a stage. I don't look at... I'm always amazed of people who actually look at social, with all due respect, but look at social media being online as a private thing. I was like, it doesn't compute for me. Like, you're online, that's not private. All these companies have breaches. Don't put anything, if you're not ready to put it on CNN, don't put it online, basically. So I use online as a stage. I never use it as something, you know, private or for me. So it's a stage for me. Most of my posts are public, and I expect them to be public. So I'm comfortable with what I share. And when you're in entrepreneurship, this is, of course, not for all people on earth. This is, if you're an entrepreneur, you need to separate between what's public and what's private. If it's something private, then create a different thing. But you need to start building your public life right now. If you're in business, you have a public life. People work with you because of you, because the brand that you are. So why not build that brand? I don't know why people are amazed, like, no, deal with my company, I'm not it. No, people deal with people. They do deals with people. There's no B2B or B2C. There is P2P, people to people. You never ever do business with people you don't like, know, and trust. So this is the first mistake. Never postpone it till when you need it. Dig your well before you're thirsty, basically. Okay. The second biggest mistake is, or colossal mistake, is bad or non-existent strategy. What does that really mean? So first of all, a lot of entrepreneurs have no realistic view of where they really are. The reality of where they are. Most entrepreneurs by nature, so we need to learn this, by nature we're very optimistic. We've just thought of an idea and now it's the $1 billion idea. We've just started working on the product and like, okay, it's working, it's happening, whatever. So entrepreneurs really need to stand, successful entrepreneurs and really entrepreneurs who are going to get funding, they need to stand on reality. So a lot of entrepreneurs don't live in reality. They have $100 but they act like they have $1,000. It doesn't work. So you really need to first know where you really are. And the second thing is their vision is unrealistic. Like, I'm going to be Uber. I'm going to be... But Uber didn't know they're going to be Uber before they built it. I'm going to be Facebook. I'm going to be the $1 billion company. You know how hard it is to build a $1 billion company? And how long does it take? And here's the kicker. They're not realistic where they are. and they have a bigger, like a vision that is unrealistic, and they have no idea how to get there. So even like, okay, I'm great, everything's happening, and we're going to be the billion-dollar company, and the investor asks, so how are you going to do that? Well, I don't know, you know, I'm going to do, still work on it, you know, persevere, hard work, all that, all these big words that mean nothing at all. Then you have to have a specific action plan, at least for the next year or two. Well, first I'm going to do this, second I'm going to do that. I'm not mean in detail, but at least there's some specificity in it, clarity on what you're going to do. And most entrepreneurs don't have that at all. It's shocking, actually. A lot of them have sat in like somewhere and they built a product. They spent 2 years, 3 years building a product. And I was like, yeah, I'm ready. The world is ready for my product right now. I said, no. The product, probably the world doesn't know your product and doesn't need it. Because why do you need to have a strategy? And in particular, you need to have a strategy as well for your fundraising. You need to have a strategy for that. Like, how are you going to find those investors? How are you going to work with them? What are you going to present with them? Because it almost always takes longer, harder than ever you think to raise money. I recently spoke with the CEO of Canva. And you know how, and any of you know Canva, canva.com? It's the tool online that is actually changing completely, like taking customers from Adobe, basically. Changing how design happens. You design online. You design all. If you don't know it, go. It's free. It's probably one of the secrets of social media. Canva.com. Go for it. So Canva. I mean, from Canvas. From Canvas, remove the S. Canva.com. Try it out. And she actually, she lives in Australia, and she still do. And she was raising money from Silicon Valley. How many pitches do you think she did till she got the funding? 300 pitches. 300. And she's building a product. I bet you that you will see this product. Wow, it's worth investing. It took her 300 pitches to get funding. But in those 300 pitches, yes? Yeah, canva.com. So, for example, Guy Kawasaki, any of you know Guy Kawasaki? He's the evangelist of Canva. Okay, so they got him as evangelist. So he was the evangelist of Apple, if you don't know him. So while she's pitching, she's building relationships with those investors, learning from them, because she said, every time I do a pitch, I learn for the next pitch. I ask them what worked, what didn't work. So it's not pitching and I get money or I don't. It's like, what can I learn more? What can I do? What do I think? What do I need to develop? And then they change that and they apply it to the next pitch and the next pitch. And that's what you need to do. You need to have that runway because it's always going to take you longer than you think. So what are the things you need to have? First, you need to have a company strategy, a realistic view where you are right now. I'm just starting. I'm in the idea phase. And where you want to go and how you're going to get there. And it's more than perseverance and hard work and a lot of passion. You need realistic steps. One of the key things to help you do that is stop thinking as an entrepreneur and start thinking like an investor. If you had money today that you worked hard to earn, okay, or somebody entrusted you with that, would you invest it in your own company? Based on what the data that you have, based on where you are, where you're going, and the steps you're going to do. And if not, what do you need to have to invest? Second, you need to have an investment strategy. Sorry, it's not that clear there. So you need to have an investment strategy. Basically, who are the investors? Like, it's not just everybody who has money you need to invest, you can accept. Remember that investors actually, when they invest in you, it's not like, here's your money, bye, we'll see you when you exit. If you exit, that is. Okay? They're going to put in the money, and they're going to make damn sure that you're actually going to produce a result. So you're actually bringing on partners. You're bringing on people who are going to interfere in your business. And depending on the term sheet that you sign, and if you're not so careful, they might own the business. So it's very important to have an investment strategy. What kind of investors are you looking for? How much money? Where are you going to put it? How are you going to use it? How much do you need so that to the next round? And almost as keeping in mind that the next round is going to take much more. time. So don't say, oh, I want just for the 6 months because the next 6 months we're going to raise. Well, probably if you next 6 months you're going to raise, are you going to start right now raising for the 6 months? Because that's much how much it's going to take. So if you're thinking in 6 months, think a year. It's going to take longer always. Even if the investors approve, like sometimes just to get the round, the people participating in the round to sign altogether takes much longer than expected. And always have a plan A when things go well, plan B when things don't go that well, and plan Z when things go to shit. Because they're always going to be. You can't imagine how many entrepreneurs cannot afford to pay $250 or $200 for something because they didn't plan for it. And say, oh, now I have to go work full-time after I spent 3 months on my startup. Really? Why don't you have like some work on the side and expect that? Did you really think that in 3 months you're going to get the product rolling, you're going to meet investors, get investment to be able to, you know, like really live as a startup? Yes.
Thank you. How do you set the duration or the plan ABC?
Okay, so think of the startups that you know the most successful. So Airbnb, for example, took them 7 years to become the Airbnb we know them. So ideally, as an entrepreneur, prepare to live for 3 years this way. If you survive, if you manage in 1 year, great. But prepare for 3 years. So prepare, have another source of income, or have enough money to at least carry you for another year without work. And what are some of the skills you can work on the side and get like some project on the side, consulting, whatever it is, so that you can provide. Or you have another, so whatever that source of income is, don't look at investment as an income. Investors hate that. Unless you're the second genius and you're working on something like a technology that really can't monetize, investors don't like to pay your salary while you actually sit around and be the entrepreneur. I don't know, any investors in the room here? Am I correct? Yeah, they don't like it. They like, okay, you're going to invest 500 and 300 of that is paying for me being an entrepreneur for the next year. Uh-uh, never going to happen. Sorry. What you want to do is like, I'm living on the bare minimum, and this is going to allow me to go out and market, go out and bring customers. That's why I'm taking this money. So I don't continue my consulting business, and I use that time to get more customers. Investors like to hear that. Yeah, I'll pay for that time because that's marketing time. Because otherwise, you have to pay somebody else, and it might be more expensive than you, and they don't know the product. Yes, you raise your hand.
But having said that, that's the truth. But then when you go for investors, if you don't work on your idea or company as full-time, then that's a negative point as well. So you're suggesting that you may be surviving. You have to plan for 3 years not having any income and then hold on to your full-time job possibly until you get traction.
No, I didn't say hold on to your full-time job.
But at least have some income.
Have something,
to survive somehow.
Yeah, full-time job will not work. You need, if you want to be a true entrepreneur, in my opinion, of course, by the way, everything I say is an opinion. It's not the truth. And please, as an entrepreneur, don't accept anything as the truth. Anything can be disrupted, changed, proven wrong all the time. This is an opinion from experience, my experience, from the experience of entrepreneurs I worked with, but still doesn't make it right. As a full-time job, you have 8 hours of dedicated time that is consuming you, depending on what job it is, unless you sit in the office raising your feet and not doing anything. Okay? So if that kind of a job, it's very hard to be an entrepreneur. Now, you can still be an entrepreneur. I did it. Okay? But is that feasible for how much time? For 3 years, that's almost impossible, I would say. Because you're going to have to go network and meet people probably at times where your job is. Okay? So it depends on that. But can you actually develop the skill? So for example, if you want to become an entrepreneur in a certain area, and most entrepreneurs unfortunately think their idea, if they don't do it now, everything, the whole world's going to crumble, complete doesn't work, like complete bullshit, there's nothing like that. There are, of course, times and places and some ideas that are very timely, and you can do that. But remember, you don't have a business. You're a startup. So can you run a few tests to test if this idea is worthwhile while you're in a full-time job? Absolutely. Run a few tests, put a landing page, test with your customers, do customer interviews while you're in your job. But when you're actually, after you've validated this is a product and this is something, there's a need for it in the market and there is value, and now you need to go market and validate, you need to spend three, four, 5 hours, then it's probably time to leave and to go take a consultancy job if you need to. But if you are in a job, maybe one of the things you need to do is say, okay, I'll stay in the job for the next 6 months and I'll save half of my salary. Then you're building for your startup, right? So I can sustain myself. And you start preparing. And so these are some of the things that you have to evaluate case by case. Make sense? All right. So have these plans, planned company strategy, investment strategy, and plan Z. So that's the second colossal mistake, is not having a strategy or a bad strategy. And the third one is seeing investors as investors. So what does that really mean? Well, think about it this way. Investors are a different form of customers. So let's look at that. What does that mean? So first of all, thinking that investors invest in innovation. I have the next innovation, so investors are going to invest in me. Or I have the next, this is the next disruptive strategy or disruptive technology, so I'm definitely going to get investment. Or I have a great vision. Those things investors don't invest in. They like them. It's good to know. It's good that you have, like, you're innovative, and but they don't invest. That's not what they invest in. Okay? So this is Mark Suster. He said, persistent, persistent, persistence. I'm surprised how few entrepreneurs follow up. What he means is that they present, they think, you don't think it's great at the time, because investors don't invest in all the innovation, but they don't follow up with them when they've developed their idea. So what do investors actually look for? Investors, as I said, is a different form of client, solve their problem. Investors have money, they want to earn more value on their money. That's a problem. They can't achieve that by investing in a, let's say, in a mutual fund or something. They make 5%, 10%. What they want to make is 25, 30%, 100, 500% on their investment. That's one of their problems. They want to invest in great companies. That's one of their problems. Solve their problems for them. Think of them as customers. Show them that you're a great investment. Don't show them you're a great company. Make sense? Help them win. Investors like to win. They don't want to know anything about this is a possibility of failure. Now, this doesn't mean don't be realistic, but show them all the steps you're making to make sure you're going to win as a company. Give them great return on value. A lot of us don't know, because we don't think as investors. How much do you think investors want as return in angel investment level? Any of you know? 10x. Anybody else? How much? Yeah, but how much? It's 10x, 30x? Yeah, it's actually between 20 to 30x. Do you know why? Because investors know that when they invest in 10 companies, 6 to 7 of them will fail by average. 2 of them will probably return what you invested. And 1 or 2 probably will succeed. So this 1 or 2 would have to substantially compensate for everyone else. So on average, angel investors make, on all the investors, the average investment return is 25% across all the investors, because there's a lot that fail and 1 or 2 that succeed. And that's why it's like, you know what, that's why they want big exits, big things. They don't want to know, like, you're going to make a couple of millions after. Then you're not ready for investment. Go sell. That's your investor, your customers. You have a question? Where's?
So would you say they're angel investors or VCs that got 25%?
Angel investors. Angel investors. As an early startup, you're all looking at angel investors. VC are a different level. Yeah, so you need to have revenue, so it's a different level of investment. So yes, this is what they invest in. So after you've done this, after you've avoided the three colossal mistakes, you still have to build a successful startup. So not only you need to avoid the mistakes, you need to build a successful startup. How do you do that? Well, this is a definition of a startup as we define it in Launch Academy. A startup is a series of experiments aimed at searching for a repeatable, scalable model. So let me repeat that. A startup is not a company. It's a series of experiments. You're just experimenting. Why you're experimenting? You're searching for a repeatable and scalable business model. Once you find the repeatable and scalable business model, you're now a company. You have product market fit, you transition to growth, and then you grow and scale. So if that's a startup, what's the definition of success? What are the requirements of success? So probably you know this. This is people, right? You need the right people. So I'll start from here. You need some luck, because obviously you can have very unlucky things happening. You need to be innovative all the time, coming up with ideas. This is not about coming up with the idea. It's about coming up with a lot of ideas. I come from the creative industry, so we know ideas. And the best way to get a good idea is to get 100 shitty ideas. That's the best way. So you have to come up with a lot of ideas. But the most important part that entrepreneurs suck at is process. Entrepreneurs strive on the next big thing, whatever. They're motivated, passionate, right? But they suck at process. Process is doing mundane things. Keep on experimenting on a day to. Think of an entrepreneur like a researcher for a drug. If a researcher for a drug acted like an entrepreneur, they just invented a medicine, they put it out there and let you have it and say, this is the greatest medicine, it's going to heal you anything. And you're going to get a lot of dead people. Okay? As a researcher, what you wanted, if you act as a researcher, you experiment, then you do a bigger experiment, and now it's like, now you get the FDA approval or the Ministry of Health approval, whatever that is. So, what is the process? The process is to avoid expensive failures. You're going to fail. The process helps you avoid expensive failures. Fail forward, fail better, fail fast. This is a process we recommend always, the lean process. If you're not familiar, read Lean Startup, read Running Lean, because this is the process for running a startup. It's a very simple process. Come up with an idea, build something simple, test it out, and take whatever you've learned from the test, whether it's failed or not, to come up with better ideas. Should I continue? Should I pivot? Should I keep on experimenting? And on and on forward. And that is what we teach at Launch Academy in our LEAP program, Lean Entrepreneur Acceleration Program. And if you're still unsure in what you want to do, at least come for our almost free workshop. This is a $15 workshop. It's called Make the Leap. And this, wherever you are as an entrepreneur, it will get you started, propelled forward as an entrepreneur. We hold one every month. So check with us to know when we're going to hold the next one. Or come ask us about anything else. I hope this was great value for you guys. If you have any questions, please let me know. I'm here. Oh, thank you very much. Do we have time for questions? Or is Shauna or...
I
guess we do.
I think we're running a bit...
We're running out of a bit of time. So I'm available here. If you have any questions, you can actually come to me and speak to me. Thank you very much.
Before you put down the mic, I need a post shot.
With the mic?
As if you were speaking with,
like
the,
this?
With the signage. Yeah, that'll be great.
Screaming?
You were speaking. Yeah. A little bit guts, right?
No,
bit,
just joking.
Yes, pizzazz.
Okay.
Pizzazz, you know? Actually, you can do something with your hands.
I don't know what to do with my hands. Let me speak to you. Hello?
One more.
I feel like a model. This guy's awesome, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Thank you, guys.
Testing, 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 test, 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 testing, testing, test, 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 testing, 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 1, 2, 3.
By the way, guys, if you want any of the slides, just email me telling me you want the slides, I'll make them available to you. Okay? Sure.
Oh, here's my email is hussein@launchacademy.ca. Here's my, if you want my cards, I'll just put them here. Sure, here's my card if you want to have them.
Just a quick question. Sure. Are you the founder of this company?
No, I'm not the founder of Launch Academy. Just
a joke for them?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. So who are the founders?
Ray and Alex. Ray Walia and Alex.
How long this company is?
4 years.
4 years, yeah. Okay. I'm interested to know their story.
Oh, okay.
As to how they launch this company.
Well, come to our, we do like that.
So Sean,
okay.
So we're essentially skipping the part
there
for a number of people.
Yeah.
Just kind of brand.
Like
you have the regular workshops.
So they just sort of do simultaneously. Just do it simultaneously. Both things happen simultaneously. That's fine too. Because some people might come.
Okay. So what do you want me to do?
Okay. So introduce yourself.
Introduce myself.
As in,
and
like you're here. You're at the
okay.
Filmmaker Roadshow, Vancouver stuff.
Okay.
That's number one. Number two.
How important is funding? Okay.
Funding and I guess.
And the show and events like this.
Events
okay.
like this and opportunities to pitch and education.
Okay, brilliant. I'll do that.
Yeah, and then you can you know plug your thing.
About this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, I'll do that.
Yeah. I initially wanted to get you like out there talking to people because like you're a content king. So.
Sure.
But I mean, if we have time, we'll do that later.
Okay. So let me do that.
Okay.
Cool. Up before anybody. So shall I go? Cool. So hi everyone. My name is Hussein Halak. I am the general manager of Launch Academy. Launch Academy is an early stage tech incubator. One of the top in Western Canada, and we help companies who are entrepreneurs who are at the early stage, from an idea to building their company, find out what to do next, get educated, get connected, and build a brilliant startup. So I'm here at the Fundica Roadshow in Vancouver and Victoria. We're in Vancouver. It's an awesome roadshow. I can't emphasize how important it is for entrepreneurs and obviously investors to come meet, connect, touch base with each other, learn what's happening in the community, what's happening in the marketplace, and make those long-term connections that will become very valuable later. What next do you want me to do? Okay, so at the Fundica Roadshow and events like this, you get to meet great people and you get to have interesting discussions. You also get to learn from thought leaders in their field. You get to meet people and know about people that you haven't known before. So you get a lot of information, a lot of valuable education, and you may just find the next direction of where to take your startup or where to get you to take your next investment and meet your next co-founder or the person you're going to partner with next. So that is why this this event is very important, and the guys have done a great job in organizing such an event. They're doing great work, so I highly recommend that you actually come in and check it out. For me, people I met? Okay. Okay. Personally, I've met with some brilliant people, some entrepreneurs who are building products that are very interesting in areas where I probably couldn't have met them in other places. I also got the chance to present to people and interact with them. So the audience was very lovely also and listening. And I got to connect with other incubators and other people who are shaping our community and shaping our ecosystem, which is always a great thing in such a show. Great? All right, awesome.
You got me in the pinch. Thanks so much.
You're welcome. Pleasure.
Test, test.
Hello. Hi, everyone. Hello. Hi. Good afternoon. How's everyone doing? Or not? Really get the attention, huh? Here. Woo! Hello. Hey. Perfect. How's the day going so far? Good? Great. So I wanted to thank all of you guys for coming out. And I also wanted to thank our national partners as well. So you've had a chance to actually listen from all of our national partners throughout the day, you know, like QuickBooks, Nethris, IBM, Canary. But one more partner, PayPal, has been here the whole day and can answer any of your online payment, you know, solution questions. So Kevin has a, you know, has set up a few interviews throughout the day. But if you guys didn't have a chance to see him or speak to him or even register for interviews, he's going to be here for the rest of the day. And I just wanted to introduce him here. Kevin.
Hi, guys. I'm Kevin. I have talked to a couple of you. I have a couple interviews scheduled. I think this gentleman over here. As Lana said, I'm over here a couple more hours. Happy to answer anything. Kind of e-commerce, accepting payments, obviously specific to PayPal. Please don't hesitate. Stupid questions are welcome. I'm over there. So please come say hi. And there's still cupcakes if you're jonesing. Yeah. Thank you, Lana.
Thank you. All right. I just thought that we'd meet him, right? Because he didn't get a chance to speak. So he's a lovely guy. All right.
Lovely.
Perfect. Thanks. Hello? Hi again. Good afternoon. Hello. Can I get a hi?
Hello.
All right. Great. I mean, I need to get your attention with this lovely panel right here. So the next panel will be focused on the revolution of the funding revolution. It'll include these lovely ladies. It'll be moderated by Humaira Hamid, who is the BDM at Futurepreneur Canada, which supports the startup community in BC. Futurepreneur Canada is a national not-for-profit focused on fueling youth entrepreneurship via financing, mentorship, and support tools to aspiring business owners age 18 to 39. Futurepreneur has also been one of the national partners of the Fundica Rocha, and they've actually helped us succeed over the years. We're very happy to have them as partners and as participants over the years. And, Humaira is going to be moderating. Besides teaching yoga and whistling, she's going to be, practicing her moderating skills. So without further ado, I'll pass the mic.
Thanks so much. You need to, when you're supporting entrepreneurs, you need to keep things fresh and always, when we heard from the morning panel today, step outside of your own bubble and keep different perspectives coming in. So some of the ways, and I know that there are many different perspectives here. So without further ado, I would love for this wonderful, very talented, very knowledgeable panel to just take a couple of lines to introduce yourselves and what it is that you do and with what organization or firm.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jill Earthy, and I am the Chief Growth Officer of Front Funder, and we're an online investment platform opening up and creating a new capital market. And what that means is we are making it easier for companies and entrepreneurs to raise funds in an open, transparent way through an online platform. And on the other side, we're really empowering a whole new group of investors who can start to participate and support these companies by investing. So it's a really exciting new opportunity in Canada.
My name's Alex Cormick, so I spoke here last year with my angel investor hat on, because I wear multiple hats. I'm a corporate securities lawyer in Vancouver here, taken over 100 companies, sold them across the border and across Canada to large organizations, and over 150 companies public. I've also am the legal advisor for the National Crowdfunding Association of Canada. I have a book coming out about equity crowdfunding shortly, and so I wear multiple hats.
Wow. I don't have a book coming out. My name is Monique Morden, and I am the Chief Revenue Officer for Lendified. I used to be the CEO for Mentio. We actually won here at Fundica last year, but we were recently acquired. Yay! What Lendified does is provide working capital loans to small businesses across Canada. And they're one of the alternative lenders that are out there and an option for all the small businesses, including startups.
Thank you all. So clearly a lot of talent and perspective and history from a variety of backgrounds. So from what you've seen in your time in the space, how do you think funding has evolved over the past couple of years specifically?
Oh, geez, I should've, that was tricky. How has it evolved? There's a lot of different options that have come out in the past few years from, crowdfunding, and depending on what type of business you're in, if that's applicable to you or not, I'm sure we'll get into that a little bit more. There's the angel side, which is a whole area to get into. I used to call it sort of the secret society, where you have to figure out who's who and network through, and there's no fast and easy way to get through that. And then of course there's the VC side of it. So it's all, if anything, it's getting more complicated, but it's giving you more options. And I think the tricky part is to figure out what's the right option for your business based on the stage that you're at, and to keep in mind where the puck is going.
Okay, so I'm going to put a different hat. So I'm going to wear my lawyer's hat on now. We've actually got a number of new exemptions that didn't exist 2 years ago, or even a year ago, for that matter. So we now have the Opry Memorandum exemption right across Canada. So Ontario was the holdout before. You couldn't basically offer securities in Ontario under that exemption. In January of this year, you now can. So you can use the Opry Memorandum to raise capital with anyone on the street right across Canada. You still require audited financial statements, which doesn't make that very useful for some people. but it is something that's available to you right across the country. The other is we've got a couple of new crowdfunding exemptions. Here in this province, we have the startup crowdfunding exemption that allows you to raise up to $500,000 in a calendar year. No audited financial statements required, no financial statements period required. There is some disclosure requirements, but it's really quite limited, and you have to use one of the funding portals that's been properly registered, either under the exemption or as an exempt market dealer or restricted dealer. We also have, in other jurisdictions but British Columbia, an exemption called 45108, or the integrated crowdfunding exemption. You can raise up to $1.5 million under that exemption. Depending on how much you're raising, you may have to have audited financial statements or reviewed financial statements, but there is an opportunity to not include audited or reviewed, depending on the amount that you're raising on that one. Again, the disclosure requirements are limited in terms of what you need to do. It's not like an offering memorandum or prospectus, but there is some disclosure that's required there. And again, you're required to use one of the funding portals to raise that capital. We also have a new friends and family exemption in Ontario. Believe it or not, Ontario didn't have a friends and family exemption until a year and a half ago. And then now they've adopted one finally, so they're more in line with the rest of Canada. And they're trying to simplify kind of how companies can raise capital. Also, we didn't have any crowdfunding portals or any internet portals except for one that dealt primarily with institutional investors. They've been around since 2007, and now we've got a number of them. We've got over 7 here in British Columbia that are operating, and we are expecting to get more. The other thing we didn't have up until probably last year was small business debt portals. So most of them are online lenders. Some of them are associated with banking institutions. Some of them are associated with institutional investors or accredited investors. But these are now new opportunities for people to participate. And we're about to launch a couple of peer-to-peer lending platforms as well, aimed at small businesses.
Excellent. You made my job really easy. That was perfect. The beauty of going after Alex. So Front Funder is one of those new online portals. We are currently the only exempt market dealer that's registered. We're registered in 8 provinces across the country, which means that we can use all of those different exemptions that Alex just outlined concurrently. So for a company that's looking to raise, let's just use an example of $1 million, they can use the equity crowdfunding exemption up to $250,000 per raise twice a year, which is where Alex got the $500,000. But then on top of that, they can also raise from friends, family, and business associates, as well as accredited investors or angel investors who are high net worth individuals. So you can bundle those. Or if they're using the offering memorandum, that also opens it up. So we're really trying to streamline the process. And for companies raising funds across the country, it is a bit of a messy regulatory environment. It can be very complicated. And so that's certainly one of our jobs at Front Funder, is to make it easier for companies to access that broader group of investors across the country, and doing it in a very open, transparent way. So anyone from, as I said, high net worth right down to the retail investor or the crowd, which is still building in Canada, or your customer can participate and actually invest in companies. So it's really, really exciting.
That's fantastic. Thank you all. And in this evolution, you've touched upon, I think, the main themes just being diversification and democratization, really, of investment into different businesses and how the regulations have been shifting to that. Specifically, how would you say that this alternative lending platform is now changing the field? And do you think that the big banks are in trouble at all?
Do you want to go
first? I don't think the big banks are in trouble, but they're definitely looking over their shoulder. And if anything, a lot of the big banks are realizing that they don't have the aptitude or capacity, I think, to really innovate. So they're, I think, looking to see what's in the market, and they'll be looking for others to innovate. And I definitely think there's going to be acquisitions probably in the future. They also have such a huge, you know, share of the market that they're not worried about it so far, and that a lot of the alternative lenders are picking up pieces of the market that the banks, quite frankly, couldn't be bothered with, and they couldn't make it economically feasible because it would take them, you know, weeks and weeks to sort of process a loan, and they just didn't have the processes and the automation to do it. So that's what a free market gets you, and that's why a lot of these fintech companies are coming in, and they're seeing that there's an opportunity here, and especially the changes in the economy. company. I think we've all seen that, you know, you don't go and work at one company for life. There's small businesses are becoming a bigger part of the economic engine for not just for Canada, but I'd say for North America. And so I think there's an evolution that's happening in the market, and this is all just part of that shift. So so the big banks, I guess I better be careful. I was going to say I think they're probably a little too arrogant to be scared. But again, that's the way the market works, and it creates other opportunities. I forget the first part of the question. I went on so long.
I was just going to add two things. I think one of the questions was around education. Well, I see education and the role of these online platforms and portals is really helping to increase awareness around opportunities, around fundraising, and also around investing. And I think that the education that's happening on both sides is really exciting, and there's a huge opportunity there. On the big bank side, I think it is interesting because I know we've been invited in to speak to a number of commercial banking groups at some of the big banks because they are curious. They're definitely watching. They want to know how they can play. And we're having some interesting conversations about that. I think the credit unions are also quite progressive, and we've had some really interesting conversations with them, and they're a little more flexible. So I think we'll see some things evolving and emerging there as well.
Alex, anything to add?
Okay, so I travel quite a bit and speak in the United States and the UK and things like that. So in the UK, Santander, which is one of the large major banks there, and some of the other kind of banking institutions over there have actually incubators where they're part of fintech and they set up a room and they provide lots of money and other free kind of stuff basically to see what people are doing and also to kind of get and acquire on an earlier basis. So some of the debt portals are backed by banks. JP Morgan just had an arrangement with OnDeck, which operates here in Canada as well. They're an American company, and you're going to see more and more of that as time goes on. So I don't think they're necessarily afraid. They're just kind of waiting for the opportunity. Banks here signaled 2 weeks ago saying that they felt that the regulatory playing field needed to be leveled. Anytime you have a large group saying that, they're just either looking for concessions or a way to shut people out. So we'll see. FCA down in the United States, which is their authority that kind of looks over banks and things like that, has invited the online portals in June of this year to come in to talk about regulation that they're looking at implementing.
And now, the conversation is shifting, whether it's just within the nation, within North America, the global conversation. Do you think that, and this is a bit of a leading question, if equity crowdfunding is going to be taking over equity as the major form of funding, and if so, how long would that take?
We're not going to be talking about equity crowdfunding, I think, in 5 years. The language is changing. Even what we used to call debt crowdfunding is now called marketplace lending. So the names are going to change over time to something else. It'll just be funding. It'll just be this is how you raise capital. It's more efficient than it basically knocks out lawyers, knocks out accountants, knocks out kind of institutional investors. It definitely democratizes the access to capital for groups that normally have not had access to it. You are seeing kind of an east-west phenomena in North America where it's the East Coast and West Coast that's getting funding, which is the same for VC and angel investment. But you are getting some traction and a bit of action in the middle, and you're going to see more of that. Here in Canada, it really is a Vancouver-Toronto type phenomena right now, and we're trying to get it organized a bit more. But part of it is educating people that it even exists first. And even like on the small business side, take a look at any of the slides that I have up online, and you'll see kind of what the portals are available to you. Most people don't know that they're there.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think the biggest issue, which Jill alluded to earlier and you're just talking about, is education. So it's going to be trying to distinguish between them all and to make sure that both sides of the market are educated in terms of the investors, but also for the businesses that are looking for funding. And again, what's the right solution for you and what's the best way to match it given the stage that you're at. So that's going to be difficult for investors, difficult for businesses, and I think difficult for the companies that are out there to distinguish themselves and get their message across in an effective way.
Yeah, I don't have too much to add, but I have noticed that even in the 6 months that I've been with Front Funder, just the language that we changed, because equity crowdfunding, that term was so new last year with some of the new legislation, that was the hot term. And that's part of what we can do, but we're a full-service exempt market dealer, so work with, as I said, all of the different exemptions. And so it's about investment crowdfunding, and we can issue any type of security, so debt or equity. So there's a lot of communication around how that works, and that will continue to evolve, definitely.
And all three of you at this point have mentioned the need for education in both the entire landscape, really, from anybody that's a potential investor now. What does that look like? What do you think are the predictions for the future that each of you are seeing, whether for the landscape in general or specifically around that education piece, and how do the players right now, the lawyers, the accountants, et cetera, that are involved in the process right now, what do they need to do to be responsive to these shifts?
I mean, I think we're going to have more and more examples and stories to tell, and I think that's going to help with the education piece as we see more companies raising funds through portals, whether it's debt or equity or still some reward, maybe. So I think that's going to help to educate, absolutely. And I've forgotten the second part. Future? What
just shifts.
Friday afternoon.
Those in the landscape. So. People that are involved in the
professional services firms. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think it is good news for everybody, because I think we are increasing efficiencies, certainly for the companies and for the investors. We're still going to need lawyers. We talk to Alex all the time. That's still going to be a need, but maybe not as deep a need. But I think hopefully there'll be more volume and there'll be more work in that way. I mean, that's one way to look at it.
Yeah, just to build on that, because based on Mentio, where we did cash flow automated cash flow forecasting for accountants, some of them saw it as a way to immediately scale themselves up and to be able to provide value-added services on top of that. Some of them were threatened by it and thought it was taking away their business. So I think this is a similar scenario. And for the progressive lawyers and accountants that are out there, they're gonna see that there's still consulting that's needed around that, whether it's advice on which way to go or how to structure things. And I think people still look to their accountant and their lawyer as that sort of advisor that they need to use to help run their business. It's hard when you're running a small business to be an expert at everything. So there's still a role there, but it's going to evolve. That would be my opinion.
Yeah, but I'm in my day job, I'm a corporate securities lawyer and I'm a transaction lawyer. That means I take companies public, I sell companies, I buy companies, and do major JVs and financings and things like that. By the time someone comes and sees me, and I would say about 80% of my practice is tech and biotech, by the time someone comes and sees me, they've already issued stock illegally. They've already breached probably 3 or 4 different provincial rules in terms of raising capital. Some of that, the only opportunity I have really is to do a rescission offer. So think about that being your first conversation, is we've got a problem.
Is that assuming unknowingly?
Yeah, unknowingly. Yeah, it's because, well, lawyers are so expensive. You say how much you charge per hour and people go like, oh my God, don't even touch me. Like, it's just like money is leaving me immediately. So that's a real concern and problem. So it's something that we have to address all the time. So that's one of the reasons I think crowdfunding is going to be good. It'll eliminate that. But, more importantly, it's giving access to capital to people that don't have connections to a daddy Warbucks, like someone who is expensive and rich in their family, or someone who's charging them a usury rate on a loan because they need capital to move their business. So now there's something better out there. You can use one of these online debt portals and get an interest rate of 8.5 to 9.5 rather than using an American Express credit card at 29.5. So there's opportunities there for new substitutes. And as far as raising equity, now women can get equity. So it may be that you've got a great little business, but maybe this is not a business that, is ever going to be a TSX venture company. It's never going to be bought by Yahoo. And now those companies can raise capital using equity platforms because they're solid little businesses and they may be great little money earners for people.
I just wanted to add to that, and really I think what a lot of these funding portals are supporting is we're sort of filling this funding gap, whether it's debt or equity, all of these portals that we need sort of that earlier stage business, as Alex said, that help them grow to the next level, which has often been referred to as the valley of death, where a company gets to that point, can't access financing, they're not bankable, and so this is, these portals are helping to fill that gap a little bit, which is great. And on the investor side, I mean, there's some stats out there that even if each of us, every single one of us in this room, whether accredited or not, are an investor and have the opportunity to now invest easily in these private companies within within limits, up to $1,500 if you're a non-accredited investor. But it starts to educate people that way too. But there's a stat that if only 0.2% of our household income across Canada goes back into this capital pool, it increases, it's a $16 billion pool. So you start to just think about that in a teeny bit. If we all shift a little bit and start to invest small amounts, and these are high risk investments, I have an obligation to say that, then that can be pretty powerful. And we just think about the economic benefits there.
Thank you all. I think we all can agree that we've barely scratched the surface of a very deep well of knowledge among all three of you. And before I open it up to the audience for any questions, so keep yourselves ready, any parting words or words of advice for the audience, specifically anybody looking to raise and getting into these portals for the first time?
I think as Monique sort of mentioned, I think explore your options. I mean, I always advise that in anything, but there's so many different opportunities out there. So make sure you talk to a variety of people to get different perspectives. But it is efficient, and it, I think it's definitely worth exploring. I'm excited about where we're at. And on the investor side, I mean, check it out. Check out some of these portals. Frontfunder.com is a great place to start. But just start exploring. See what companies are doing. Or also on the company side, just to see what companies up there are looking, what the valuations are, what they're, how they're promoting themselves and telling their stories and attracting investors. There's a lot of great learning opportunities out there.
Yeah, and I think there's more of an opportunity to sort of dip your toe in the water as opposed to, you know, going out full force. So you can do a smaller raise and test out some of these options and sort of learn from that and have a chance to iterate, which is what we all do in building technology companies. So it's nice and safe and friendly that way as well, is what I would say.
I look again, going back to equity crowdfunding now for a moment. So just crowdfunding period. Your first thing should be, is this something that lends itself to a pre-sale or a perk kind of campaign first and foremost? So if you don't have to give away equity and you don't have to take on debt, don't do it. Go that route first and foremost. You can then build off of that kind of perk or pre-sale campaign and build that into an equity later on, or you could build it into a debt as well. So, you know, there's different ways to kind of stack that. Good businesses will get funded. It doesn't matter if your business is a bad business. It doesn't matter what tool you're going to utilize to try to raise capital. You won't be able to raise capital, period. So valuations ends up being kind of key here again. Oftentimes we see companies that think they've got an idea and they're worth $3 million just because they have an idea. Execution's king. Your idea is worth nothing, and unless, you know, a willing investor says it's worth whatever percentage that they're receiving. So that's your clue of how much your company's really worth. So if your valuation is totally out of whack, you won't be able to raise equity financing whatsoever. You may be able to raise debt because that's not relevant. You may be able to raise perk or pre-sale because, again, it's not relevant. So take a look at the stack. And then I guess the other thing is you can raise anywhere from $10 to, we have a client that's raised down in the States $80 million. Using an online portal. So this is not just for startups. You can keep coming back and utilizing them. As Jill said, sorry, I have to look. I keep on wanting to call her Jillian. I don't know why.
Okay, that's my real name.
Maybe that's why. As Jill was saying, you know, FrontFunder is an EMD, so they can basically offer securities under any exemption whatsoever, as long as it's in a private placement setting.
Thank you very much. Really valuable, tangible advice. I hope I saw some people taking down notes, which is great. Opening up the floor to questions now. If you do have a question for one of the specific panelists, please just let us know, and we'll bring the mic around.
Hi. I had two questions for two beautiful angels. One, you are talking about, Monica, talking about the building technology company. Last year, this Canadian company called the Planet of Earth that have been bought by an American company. Do you think this is a good company?
I don't know.
Yeah, because Planet Earth, this IT company, right? And they have been bought by the American company. And then that's come to us and then go into the market. Do you think this is a good come to you? Let me see. Yeah, that's called a high risk investment too.
I couldn't answer that without knowing a little bit more about the company. But
how do you define the high risk investment?
Well, I think certainly
in the term of the
most of the companies that we work with, because of the stage that they're at, are considered high risk. So that, and they're longer term. So we also say that any return may not be realized for 7 to 10 years. These are earlier stage. Well, and as Alex said, they could be growing companies too. But that's how we deem high risk, is just the stage that they're at.
So long, 7 to 10 years.
Pardon?
No.
Yes. Exactly. So that's part of the. There's no. There's limited liquidity at the moment in these types of private companies. Yeah. And it could be earlier. You never know. But that's part of the risk you have to take. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I have two questions. One is there any regulatory requirement to protect the interest of the investors after some threshold?
Yes, very much so. So that's what Alex was referring to, the different exemptions. So as an accredited investor, there are no, you can invest as much as you want to, but you have to review, there's certain documentation available to review, and you make that investment decision. On the friends, family, and business associate exemption, the idea is that you know you have a direct relationship with the founder or the entrepreneur, and you're investing. It's a personal connection, so there's a trust factor there and a reputational factor there that you're making your investment decision on. And on the retail investor now, which is the equity crowdfunding exemption, there is a limit. So that's where an individual in BC and 4 other provinces, it varies per province, but here it's a max of $1,500 per investment, up to a total of $10,000 per calendar year.
Okay, no, what my question is, like, once you make the investment, mm-hmm. the business is being run by the directors or the owners.
Yes.
What regulations are there for them to ensure what they are reporting out of the performance of the business? Is there a regulation to that effect? Do they need to get audited by an external auditor or to get it reviewed,
so,
the accounting?
So the need for audited financial statements in British Columbia is dictated by the BC Company Act. So the BC Company Act says that you have to get all your shareholders to agree to not have audits, otherwise you have to do an audit every year, so you need a unanimous consent from the existing shareholders. For 45108, which is the integrated crowdfunding that's not available here in Canada, here in British Columbia, and as well as the offering memorandum version that Ontario has adopted and also being adopted in 5 other provinces on April 30th, if you use that exemption, they're required to provide financial statements every year for the rest of the life of the company. They're also required to provide kind of what I call material change, like a material change report of some sort on certain events occurring in the company. For instance, like a change of control or the sale of the majority of the assets and things like that. So there are some trigger events that require them to make some disclosure. But generally speaking, you should think, if you're investing in a company, unless you have a contractual agreement with that owner to provide further documentation, there is no requirement.
We do encourage it, obviously, and we certainly suggest that there's communication proactively going out to the investors on a monthly or certainly a quarterly basis. And then also with the securities regulators, once we have worked with the company, they have to submit a form to the securities regulators around who are the investors that have invested in this round. So there are some areas, some levels of protection in place.
Sure. Thank you.
Hello. So my question is about investors and their opinions on equity crowdfunding. The reason I'm asking is because I asked another startup about half a year ago what their opinion was about equity crowdfunding, because I love the idea as a former accountant. Well, still an accountant, but not by job. And so they told me that they didn't want to go anywhere near it with a 10-foot pole. And the reason was because they went to this pitch event in Victoria where one of the startups mentioned that they were doing it, and the investors at this pitch event just like ripped them to shreds. And so after seeing that in front of other startups, in front of all these investors, they didn't really, they didn't want to do that. They were scared. So I'm wondering, are investors, VCs and angels, are they starting to warm up to it? And is there anything you can say that will like make them feel more comfortable if you do want to go down that route? Thank you.
I'll just quickly answer, then I'll pass it to Alex. But I would definitely say that investors are warming up to it. And what we found is that we have what sort of a lead investor model, where we actually have a number of angels now or companies who are coming to us who already have some key lead investors in. And they're now coming to us and using a platform to top it up. So you get the benefit of having the strategic investment and then able to still use the marketing benefits of gaining some more brand champions. So it's taking time. It's like education. And there's certainly some people who are more easily converted than others. So we'll continue that. But we've also looked at different ways to manage the number of investors as well, voting trust agreements. There's different ways to mitigate some of the concerns that those investors have too.
Okay, so I am an angel investor. I'm invested in 8 private companies and I've got 22 public companies in my portfolio. Mike Volker and I were on a panel. Mike Volker's like a super angel here in town. Has started Bantech, part of Keiretsu Forum. I'm a member of those two groups as well. So I think it was about 4 years ago, Mike and I were on a panel about equity crowdfunding, and he essentially said no investor in their right mind would ever be part of it, blah, 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 blah. He's changed his opinion about that. Down in the States, you have a lot of kind of VCs that are now participating in these. You have a number of different angel investors that are also active participants. We were just talking about Peter Thiel from PayPal. Like, certainly he's definitely interested in the debt space in particular and participating on that level, but probably more as an accredited investor outside of a portal setting more than anything else, just in terms of the size that he's looking at. But I would say that, you're going to see a total change. A lot of the more successful portals in the UK are actually run by angel groups or started by people who were super angels.
I think the important thing is, too, is to realize that it depends on your business if it's a good fit. So if you're B2C, those types of sites can be great. If you're B2B, it might not be the best way to go. So you're going to look like an idiot if you're using a certain tool that is not going to fit with your business or the stage that you're at. And that's probably what's going to make investors go, does this person know what they're doing? But if you use it effectively, like there's like Pebble raised, I don't know, like gazillions on there, and it was also a way for them to market their product. So it was a brilliant strategy for them.
How do you calculate the valuation of a company?
she laughs into the mic and passes it to me.
It's like, well, that's a big question.
Okay, so you can take a look at kind of the angel presentation I did last year for Fundica. And in the back, there's actually a slide in the resources that has links to six different valuation calculators. So you can go and take a look and see. You're not going to like what it comes back with. Go to slideshare.net and just put my name in, Alex Cormick, and just look for Fundica, like the angel investor thing. And you'll see that in the resources, there's a link to that. And that'll give you kind of a starting point. But generally speaking, you know, it's a bit of an art. So it comes down to, again, how it's done in the angel world is usually a discussion. You basically tell us what you think you're worth. We basically beat you up and say you're not. And we do comparatives, and we show you kind of who else has been raising money in your particular group and where you are compared to them and what you have. Execution is king. And the willingness of an arm's length party, that determines kind of what that valuation really is. And it changes. So it used to be when I was kind of on my corporate securities law hat now. So if I had a tech or biotech company, I probably would not shop it here in Vancouver because I would get a better valuation in the States. And depending on kind of the particular type of company, I may get a better valuation on the East Coast than the West Coast or down in Florida, so in the South. So that would be the dictator for me, having experience raising capital with clients and talking to different people where they were going to get the best money. So if I'm dealing with my company clients, that's where I want to go. If I'm dealing with my angel, you're worth nothing, and we're starting from there and going forward.
Yeah, I was going to say, it really depends what stage your company is at. So if you actually have revenue, then you start to have metrics that go into that. If you're at the early stage and it's concept, it's all about the idea. It's about the team. They'll say team, team, team. Yeah. So it's all because the team is how you're going to be able to execute on it. So it's the track record of the team. And if you've got a track record that you can execute and the idea is half decent, then they'll say, okay, I believe this person can do it. If you're an unknown entity, then they're going to go, I don't know, that's even riskier. So
if you're Bill Gates and doing a startup, you're worth a lot more than you're,
he's,
you know,
looking for funding.
Then you're a high school student coming out. But you know, I've taken one client company, I'll give you a perfect example. They came to me because they got an offer from Microsoft. Microsoft said, we'd like to buy you. And they wanted to buy them for $250,000. So fine, he comes and he shows me what he has. I look at it and go like, oh, do you mind if I show this to another lawyer that I know down in Los Angeles? I think this might be worth a little bit more than that. I just want to get a better idea on the company. And so anyway, I put it to the other lawyer, and he goes, oh, my God, I've been looking for this. So he said, we can raise $10 million tomorrow on this. So we did. We literally raised $10 million, had to have a conversation with him, and said, look, you'll get a minimum of three. We got to put some white heads around you. And basically kind of pretty some things up and stuff, and it'll be probably 2 to 3 years and we'll do an exit then. And that's what we did. So we put $10 million around the company. We ended up selling that to a U.S. entity for I think that one was 35. He was 21 years of age. My first name's Alex. His girlfriend thought that I was a man. When she called and found out it was a she rather than he, I think she flew over the Lionsgate Bridge to get into my office, and she came to every meeting after that. So she saw her golden ticket, and she wasn't letting go. Didn't matter how young he was.
Great. And being conscious of time, we'll take one more question if there is from the floor before we close up. Any last parting thoughts? Are we good? All right, that's it. Sure.
Just because no one's asking another question. I love the idea of offering memorandums as well, but I don't know much about them. Are people using them a lot here in Vancouver, or is it something that people don't really use much? Thank you.
I'll start and then I'll pass it to Alex again. It is starting to be more used. It has been around in BC for quite a number of years. Our CEO likes to call it the ultimate crowdfunding tool, and it's pretty phenomenal. We're definitely seeing it with the companies coming through our platform now. A number of them are starting to use it. It's becoming more popular.
So the offering memorandum has been around for quite a while. Who has been using is essentially investment funds. 50% of the offering memorandums in this province are usually by investment funds. The other 50% or close to 48% is by either mortgage investment corps or real estates. So in 2008, that was a watershed year for the real estate companies. They kind of weren't aware of it either. They went from offering about $200 million under that exemption the year before to $1.2 billion that particular year in this province alone. So the offering memorandum can be very, very effective in raising capital, but you do have to have audited financial statements. It is a little bit more robust. There is some liability exposure to directors and officers in terms of you got to make certain representations and they need to be correct. But it is unlimited amount. You can raise an unlimited amount on it. You can refresh it, you know, every 6 months with new financial information or any material change and keep raising on that document.
Great. And with that, Monique, Alex, Jill, thank you so much for your time and for your expertise and sharing that a little bit with the audience. And for those that are in the room, enjoy the rest of the Fundica show. I know that there will be the live pitches coming up soon and then the awards shortly after. Thanks.
test, 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 test.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, because
you need to enforce your shit.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, I didn't
enforce
know who
it
else.
Like it's hot. Well,
I got who's staying.
No, no, no. Enforce it like it's hot. And, we're not able to match. Yeah. Not able to do.
I can barely. I barely know how to speak to you.
I have a girl crush. Massive girl crush. Massive.
Alex with an X.
You know.
So this next talk is going to be how long? 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
No, we're going to start in 5 minutes or what?
Well, what time is it?
It's like 3.
Shit,
yeah,
man.
We're real behind. That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't know if we have time to do this.
Interview?
Yeah.
No, you need to interview her.
Women passing on useful information for a change.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's awesome that it wasn't marketed as a woman power.
Oh yeah, and I
like
appreciate that,
a lot.
That even
yeah.
more.
Absolutely. That came up.
That
came up,
and even when we're gonna do women in tech fireside chats, we're gonna get a male there.
Yeah.
And it's not gonna be, oh, are you a woman? Like, do you feel victimized? Do you feel empowered? How do we empower?
First of all, I've been practicing law since 1994. I did my master's in law in 1992. So I've been around for a long time. My clients have never asked and never said, I don't want to deal with you because you're a woman. So when I started out, one of the larger firms, someone at the firm had said to me, before I started there, saying, because I spent a year and a half in Hong Kong. I lived in Hong Kong. Anyway, so one of the guys at the firm said, well, you know, the Asian clients, they're not going to want to deal with you. And I've never had a problem. I would say about 30% of my clients are from mainland China, from Taiwan, and from Singapore. Basically, they don't care. They frankly care. All they care about is, can you execute? Can
well,
you
that's
execute?
The thing. I did my undergrad and graduate studies in engineering. I've never felt the difference. Never.
People are afraid of me, but I take that as a compliment. They won't turn their back. They go like this.
And I have a huge girl crush on Alex, by the way, just to let you know.
Well, when you're smart,
I'm glad she didn't hear it, but I have to say it again. Maybe I will.
It came out here.
Is this being live streamed?
It doesn't matter.
No.
I don't understand why these things come up, but it's the new latest thing for people. It's a marketing angle is what I look at.
So I just said on the live stream I have a huge girl crush on Alex, and it's being live streamed. So I just, maybe if you do hear it, then I just come. I'm just being honest. So we're just going to have to interview her because
we're
running behind on time.
I'm
really sorry.
Okay, so we just want to get a couple of quotes.
Okay.
Mainly, you've been now have this history with Vandika, and I think we just want to get a couple of testimonials of how it's been useful for you and why you think it's useful for the ecosystem at large.
Okay. Let me think.
You can think about it. I'll stand over there so I can shoot it.
Okay.
And then I'll have you stand.
Okay. I don't have a card with me, but if you go to alexcormick.com, it's on there. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Perfect. Okay.
Thank you.
So, Rich, I'm just going to tell Mark that he has like 15 to 20 minutes because we're...
Hi.
I've actually just reached out to you on LinkedIn because I know the way of sort of to see if I can sort of contact you.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
I was
sure.
just interested in a few things that you were saying there, sort of to see if you're a match around a number of different things. But yeah, I mean, it'd be great to get some advice from you, sort of a steer around you know, certain things that are going on in my life and with my business. And it's a really interesting insight.
Yeah,
really interesting.
It's a little bit different than most people.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did have an idea as well. So a friend of mine was a professor at Toronto, and now he's a professor here, but he did a startup. And he kept talking product at all his investor
product
meetings.
Product market fit.
And then eventually he said, his last meeting, he eventually said, okay, this is what my numbers look like. And then his you know, his VCs were like in tears, like, oh my God, you're finally talking our language, right? Like, you know, because he has traction. He's had traction forever.
Oh.
you know?
Oh, number one thing I tell people.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right? This is what I'm saying. So I knew it would resonate with you. So I want to know also your nugget. When you see people grow, what is like sort of one thing that you love seeing people transition from in terms of mindset?
You're asking questions I can't answer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or an example of a nice mindset change.
So are you going to ask me the question, or I'm just going to basically throw stuff out there and you're filming?
Yeah. Is that the latter? Because.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll try to keep it clean, so I don't have to ask.
Okay. So you can.
Yeah, Fungica, and then key nugget for 12.
Okay. Hi, I'm Alex Cormack, and they've asked me to talk a little bit about Fundica. This is my second year at the conference, and the reason why I come is I think small companies are very, very valuable, and Fundica is doing an amazing job in educating companies about what they need to do to raise capital, get funding, and actually advance their businesses. Love them. I saw some great companies. Certainly looking forward to seeing who ends up winning the conference. I screwed that up. Okay. Okay. No, I can look in the camera. Hi, my name's Alex Cormack, and I'm here at Fundica's event here in Vancouver. It's the second year I've attended as a speaker of the event, as one of the angels looking at the pitches of the companies. I love participating in Fundica because the quality of companies are quite great. I'm always impressed with the companies that come in, but I'm also impressed with what Fundica does, which is teaching companies how to raise capital, what they need to do in order to move their business further. Okay, so what I'm going to do is basically talk from an angel investor, investors, what investors are looking for.
Exactly.
Okay. As an angel investor, one of the things companies ask again and again and again is, what do I need to say to investors or tell investors in order to raise capital? Lead with your strong foot. So if you've got traction, tell people, I've got sales. If it's a matter that you've got a great team and that's your strongest strength, tell them about that strongest strength about your team. If it's your product market fit and the market is just loving what you're doing and you need to kind of just build further, tell them. Tell them. We can't tell what's in your brain until you put it out there. But the number one thing is traction. If you've got traction, angels want to know that.
Yeah, of course.
And if I have to dub it.
But no, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Test. Test. Test.
Okay. So I'm Mark Eversfield. I'm the market research consultant here. Hi, Richard.
Hi.
How you doing? Richard was in one of my seminars.
Yeah, good one too.
And thanks. I'm a market research consultant here at Small Business BC. I come from UVic, the market research firm, BC Stats. BC Stats is the provincial equivalent of StatsCan. And I work on some projects. Yeah, okay. Work on some projects around BC, or Small Business BC as well, on data and geodata and market research. So,
how about the open data?
Yeah, we're going to talk about that.
Okay.
I'll show it to you on my beautiful slide that I don't have. So my presentation is Market Researcher Action Plan, and why the title? Well, I was doing an interview for, I think it was Rogers Telecommunications, about market research, and I gave them a scenario where a small business, what they would do to conduct their market research to start their business. And they kept on coming back to me saying, but Mark, what do they do after that? And it just really struck me as the myth that's out there, that somehow market research is not action. That if you're doing your market research, you're not actually doing anything. Well, you are. You're setting the tracks for what your future holds by doing that market research. You're discovering the green lights, the amber lights, or the red lights of what your future holds. That's what you're doing when you're doing your market research. So it's a real, and that's where the title comes from. And so what we've got then, so what I'm going to talk quickly about today is why market research? Why do you want to research your market? The process for tech market research or for innovative market research. Some of the resources that you can have a look at, open data, for example, really important part of the resources that are available to us. Some search tips and techniques, and then some resources and tips on industry trends. So if you want to, make sure you're jotting down some notes, because they usually are pretty helpful.
The major thing for the market research is see the pattern of money.
Exactly. Yeah, that's one of the components of market research. Most, in my opinion, most critical, but one of many that's important for sure. Okay, so that's what I'm going to talk about today. So why market research? Assessing your market potential of your idea or your business that you're going to get into, really important here. And that comes down to, and you know, I'm the last act here today, but in my opinion, I should have been the first, because that's what we do first before we do anything else, is check out whether this idea of ours has legs or not. That's the first thing we do. We don't get into management teams and three-year projections and so forth. We want to see if this thing has legs before we do anything else. And so, really critical. So defining the products and services that you're going to offer. And that comes down to thinking about what you're going to be doing. And in all my seminars that I teach, I'm always talking about goals, because goals drive everything. And everything falls out of having those certain goals that you want to achieve. So defining the products and services are going to be key. There's also an element in there about sitting down and thinking about it. There's an old saying that you don't know what you think until you write it down. And that's by the Chief Justice for the U.S. Supreme Court was talking about that. I was watching an interview with him. And that strikes so true with what we do in our lives. We can have assumptions rattling around our heads. So thinking about defining those products and services, features and benefits is going to be important there. Also, what are the benefits for your idea? And but first of all, has anybody tested a concept here? Has anybody come up with an idea and tested a concept? Yep, one, two, three, a lot. Okay, well, I'm preaching to the converted. Am I preaching to the converted? Or what is your opinion, sir, of testing your concept and market research?
Testing my concept actually led that after I went through my friendlies on market validation.
Your friendlies?
Yeah, the friendlies.
Okay.
Taking it to the real people. I
right.
Getting the high fives I expected, which actually led me to do a major pivot in the business.
I love it. So when you talk, in the earlier presentation, when they talked about the three biggest mistakes of entrepreneurs there, and talking to your friendlies, right? And he talked about how entrepreneurs are positivists, right? They see the glass half full. I'm an economist. I come from an economics background, and I could care less whether if it runs or not. The fact is, it's a reality that I want to discover is what's going on. That's my goal in discovering the reality. So talking to friendlies, that's a nice start if your market are friendlies. That's it. But if you're going to go outside that, then you face reality, right? What the market has. And that's my big goal in discovering what that market has. And it's tough. It's tough to discover. Why is it tough to discover what the market wants? Sometimes the market doesn't know what it wants, right? And so that's tough as well. You've got to think about strategies to get around that problem of when you ask somebody, is this a great idea? And they go, yeah, yeah, yeah. But will they buy it? When they actually have it in the store, will they buy it? That's the decision process that's going to be key in your success. So the friendly idea. So the idea is discovering reality. That's what market research is, discovering the reality out there. Big key about that is how do clients value your idea? I'm not selling my seminar, but I spend a whole day talking about how to evaluate prospective clients' value of your idea. And it is, there are ways and techniques of going about that. So what alternative options are there for your target? I love this. When you talk to your friendlies about your idea, before you even developed your idea, did you ask them how they solved it? Was it a problem that your idea solved? And so did you ask them how they do they solve the problem? Here's the problem. How do you solve it? Yeah. That's right. Yeah. So the idea is that there may be other alternatives. I get clients coming to me, Mark, I've got this great idea about solving this problem. And I said, well, what happens? Why don't you just do this? And then you'll find what you're looking for because they had some kind of solution that was going to help me find something when I lose it. And I thought of another way of finding that thing instead of their solution that costs nothing. So it's an idea of presenting a problem to them and they come up with an alternate solution, something that you never thought of. So be careful about that. That's one way of testing your idea. And then, of course, so the whole idea behind market research is evidence. I love that term when I discovered it for market research, evidence. What does that say to you, evidence? It doesn't say opinion. It doesn't say what you think. It's evidence, right? So give me an example of what evidence might be in my market research. Anybody want to give me?
Solid figure.
Sorry?
Solid figure. Solid, S-O-L-D, solid figure.
Sales figures. Sales figures?
Yep.
Yep. Yep. Trends, yep.
Distorted facts.
Distorted as evidence. As undistorted facts, evidence. So give me an example of an undistorted fact.
Data?
Yep, for sure.
Oh, great.
It's up on the screen.
All right, great. Yay. Hoo-hoo. So, if I can just...
So there's left and right.
Oh, sorry. Right. So where are we? We're only here anyways. Evidence, right? And facts, and so sales, and...
POC.
Sorry?
POC, proof of concept.
Proof of concept, exactly, right? So really important parts, evidence. So the idea is that your market research is an argument for why your idea should exist in the marketplace. That's what market research is about. Do you have any comments in the back?
Well, I was going to say demographics would be an example.
Demographics, yeah. What's happening with your demographics? So I would have one restaurateur that came to me, I want to set up this restaurant. And Richard, remember I talked about this in the seminar. I had a guy saying, I'm really excited about starting up a restaurant in Kitts, right? We looked at the evidence of per household spending on restaurants around the Kitts area in the last 5 years, and going down during that time that he came to me. What's another number? Yep.
So comparing your monthly active users to your total user registered base?
Absolutely, absolutely. What's happening? So my son-in-law is working for a tech company. They went to VCs. They're pitching to VCs, Blue Sky Effect. And he's telling me how they're having real problems getting financing for their project. Evidence, right? I said, what was the annual sales 2 years ago? They said $500,000, that's great. What was your last year's sales? $350,000. Bad evidence, right? No wonder nobody's going there. Your evidence says this is something's wrong. So evidence, critical, right, when we're looking at that. Okay. So let's have a look at what else have I got other going on here. So a strategy for the market research then. Bplans.com is good for a lot of activities. It's free. There are examples of business plans. And so you can get ideas of not just the bit, and I said, remember I said market research before the business plan? There are components of market research in those examples of business plans that are critical for you to have a look at. That's important. Breaking your information needs down into categories. So if market research defined is collecting, analyzing, interpreting information on your target market, your customers, your competitors, and your industry trends, that's the definition of what market research is. You can start breaking your information down needs into what would be some of the categories that you would want to break it down into. What's the most important part? If you don't have these, you don't have a business, in my opinion. What are they? Customers. So you can break your categories down in maybe a customer category, information about your customers, and maybe that might be primary and secondary information about your customers. What's another thing besides, that's the demand side, being an economist. That's the demand side of my business. What's the other side? Partners, not so much, but I've got demand and I've got supply. So supply means competitors. What's happening with my competitors? What primary information have I gained about my competitors in terms the way they respond to Facebook queries about their product or service? How many times do they post? What kind of service? How do they respond to problems? I'm a big cyclist enthusiast. I look at Simon's Bike Shop and I look at the way they've responded to people saying, oh, this place is crap. And they say, sorry, we had a bad service. They just zip their lip. They don't open up any kind of problems. That's their strategy in the way they deal with dealing with social media. Okay, so what other kinds of things are we looking for? Defining the needs as specifically as possible. And that assumes you're going to be looking at research topics for your business as well, which a lot of them don't. Formulating hypotheses and assumptions, watch out for that, right? That's the old, we don't know what we think until we write it down, the formulating hypothesis. So I had one guy that put together a new revolutionary type of clothing for snowboarding. But his whole assumption, which he never tested throughout the entire time until he saw me, was whether people wanted that, whether people thought there was a gap in the marketplace or not. He never even asked that. So you got to go to the hard places and ask the tough questions because the answers you may not like. And so that's critical about watching out for hypotheses and assumptions. Okay, yeah, secondary data and primary data. What's an advantage of secondary data? Anybody want to give me an idea of what's the advantage of secondary data? Secondary data being information that somebody else has conducted, somebody else has accumulated. It's cheaper, yeah. That's a great advantage of secondary data. More extensive, yeah. What else?
Redundancy.
Sorry?
Redundancy.
Redundancy?
That means the
operator. No. Credibility, right? Secondary information, credible source for that, really important. What's a disadvantage? What are some of the, and so as what's an advantage of primary data then? Would be an advantage of primary, of doing it yourself, of creating, doing your own surveys, and going out and collecting your own information. What would be an advantage of that?
Relevant and targeted
to your particular needs. So you're the one crafting the question. You're the one that have set the goals on what you want to achieve. And those questions achieve it, right?
Most variable to customer.
Sorry?
Most valuable to customers.
Most valuable. There's the most important part. Part of that was bad, but most important right there is that you're talking to customers, right? You're not sitting behind a desk getting somebody else's work, looking at somebody's. You're talking to customers, qualitative information that you're getting from customers about what they think of your idea, how much they would be willing to pay for it, how often would they be using it, those types of pieces of information. Sorry?
Fulfill their needs.
Fulfill their needs, absolutely. So, but what's a disadvantage of primary information? What kind of problems can I run into if I conduct my own survey?
Waste your time.
Time, yeah, takes up a lot of my time. Bias, unrepresentative samples. What about questions? When I ask you, how long did it take you to do your business plan? What do I mean? Do I mean from when you sat down and started writing on the paper to when you finished writing on the paper, or when you started it to the actual time sat at the desk working on it? Which do you mean? So in one answer, I might get 24 hours. In another answer, I might get 24 days or 2 months. So be careful. It's the interpretation of questions, right, and validating that those answers. So that can be a problem for primary data.
Don't give confidence to customers.
Sorry?
You don't give confidence to customers.
You don't give confidence to customers?
That means that you get the primary data for the first choice for customer, secondary for the customer too. The customer finds that you have so many choice for him or her.
Yeah, yeah. There's a process for that that we can talk about for sure. Did I break this thing? Yeah, I think, or did I break it? Can I use a keyboard? So quantitative data is all about numbers. That's the what. That's your big data, right? That's your open data. That tells us a lot about the what. Why don't I just use open data? Why don't I just use big data? Well, first of all, I'm a small business. I can't afford big data. Big data costs a lot. Great, thanks. So why can't I just use big data?
Because it consists too many rational and irrational structured or unstructured data.
Sure, but let's assume that there's rational data. But why not? It doesn't tell us the why, right? So when Bart on the Beach, their data said that people were not coming back for a second visit to watch their Shakespeare stuff. That's what their data said. Didn't tell them why. How are they going to find that out with data? They have to ask. They have to ask the why, the qualitative stuff. They found out that on rainy nights, they couldn't hear the actors. Tempted to turn it off, yeah. Yeah, I was getting feedback.
Well,
see?
Maybe you're just too close. It's too far. You have to keep it
closer. Okay. Five minutes, okay. Let's fly through this then. Okay, so so that's the primary stuff. Okay, so process here, we talked this about already in terms of identifying the opportunity, and this assumes that you have an idea, that you've seen some gap in the world, and you have an idea to address that gap. Okay? There are other strategies that talk about most of the people that come to our door have an idea to address a gap. That's what's happening. versus this isn't a strategy to think, well, what, how can I make the world a better place? This is already assumed that you have an idea to address a problem, a pain point. So opportunity identification, confirming what that pain point is in terms of interviews and surveys. Then you go out and you get some feedback in terms of how people would need that and what they'd be willing to pay and who they see as their competitors, all those different components. Then you go back and then you create that product based on that feedback. Then you take that out into the world and see what kind of feedback you're going to get on how their attitudes are around. What do you think the biggest driver is in decision making when people purchase products or service? What's the biggest decision maker for people buying products and service? Anybody want to give me a guess? It's pretty primal. Sorry? Sorry? You need it? But why do they need it? Why do they? Is it value, do you think?
Ego.
Ego? And what's attached to ego? Emotion. Emotion is attached. As rational as I think as I am as a statistician, when I look at my decisions, there's always emotion anchored to those decisions. There was a CFO of a big major company. There's a story that I was listening to down in the States. He got a tumor in his brain around his emotion center of his brain. He had that removed. Now, before, when he was signing big contracts for this company, financial contracts, now he couldn't decide on whether to use black or blue ink when he signed contracts. That's how immobilized he was, as not having that emotional determinant.
As after
the operation. Lost his family, lost everything, lost his job, lost everything, as a result of not having the emotions. They're always anchored. Think of any decision you're going to make, whether it's fuel economy on a car, why do I want to save it? Whether it's financial investment, there's always an anchor of emotion based on those decisions. And that's when you're doing some feedback on prototypes of ideas, seeing what the emotion is. That's where you're going to connect, make that connection for sales.
You want the EQ, upgrade the IQ.
Yeah. Okay. And so typically, so we want to involve the customer in the beginning in the developing of the concept. Experiencing the solution, using focus groups for idea generation and screening. Don't use focus groups for perceptions and preferences. Don't use focus groups for that because it's a group, it's a social environment. That's not the way we shop, unless it is the way we shop for this particular commodity, that it's in a group setting, but then it would be in friends and so forth. So be careful about focus groups using that. This is a big innovation. I come from an era where I had to have a clipboard and a pen and people would avoid me like the plague. When I went to try and ask some questions. But today, with mobile phones and the free apps that are available that automatically upload that you can analyze, it just makes collecting data and information on your particular topic so easy. It's really a big bonus, and it's free. Demographic information, psychographic information, watch out about that. There's 68 Canadian psychographic. If you check my tweets out on Twitter at SBBC Insights, or just Google. Yeah, more importantly, Google site PSYTE 5 postal lookup. Google that. PSYTE 5 postal lookup. Use that. And you'll get a little tool that'll tell you what the psychographic profile is of the dominant group in your neighborhood. You'll be able to plug that in and get. And you see, I have dogs, so I'm walking in my neighborhood, so I know my neighborhood pretty well. I know almost all of my neighbors. And when I look at the profile for my neighborhood versus who lives there, it's pretty scary in terms of how accurate it is. So psychographic groups is important. And then secondary resources. Look, libraries are no longer libraries of yesterday. They have free databases that we can go online from the comforts of our own home and access periodical indexes, company directories, newsstand databases. Incredible. Open data. You talked about open data. Data BC is the result of open data. It's a new office in BC. They can be really helpful. Cedar, yeah. And then, of course, people don't think of Twitter and LinkedIn in terms of secondary market research sources, but they are, big time. Because the Sauder schools, a Harvard Business School, big business people, small business people. Remember earlier when they were talking about the three mistakes, and I was going to crash his party, but I didn't. But when he was talking about using LinkedIn to get your network built, and he was saying you got to offer value added. How many people use Google Alerts with their LinkedIn? One? Anybody else use Google Alerts with their LinkedIn? I wanted to crash his party. I kept my mouth shut. Because when he says on the weekend, yeah, whatever I bump into, that's what I post. No. Here's what you do. You use Google Alerts with LinkedIn. This is what I do. I spend 20 minutes a day. I open up my inbox. Boom. I've got a whole source of stuff I can, because I've set it up. So I've got a whole source of topics that I can post about on LinkedIn and Twitter. Stuff that's relevant for who wants to follow me. So I can provide value added. So that's my rant for today about that. Setting up automatic tools. The other big thing about market research, and more for secondary market research, is watch out for the jargon. Because when I want to open up a boat chartering business, that's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for marine tourism. That's my jackpot phrase for getting information about boat chartering. It's the analysts that you're they're writing about it that you are concerned about, not the practitioners. Okay, this is the stuff at the library, the Vancouver Public Library. A lot of them have periodical index. It's content searching. It's not keyword searching. We've got expensive databases like iBiz that show this type of information of industry growth over the next 5 years. BC Stats, where I come from, that's great for population. If it's age-related, your target market's age-related. Is it increasing, decreasing? What's happening with your group? Google Alerts is great. I could talk more about that. As I said, Twitter and LinkedIn, important for that. That's it?
No.
I've got the cane, folks. Yeah? Okay. The competition as well. Your USP, your unique selling proposition here. Does it increase productivity? And is it easy to understand? That's really critical there. The industry trends, the big one I want to talk about here is that SpringWise. Has anybody got a newsletter to springwise.com? Put up your hand if you've got it, springwise.com. Nobody's got letters from springwise.com. Okay, check it out because it's an international database of business ideas that come through every day. And that's what I post about as well, springwise.com.
The USA or?
The world. Yeah, that marketplace. So springwise.com, am I in show mode? I don't think I'm in show mode. That's okay. And Trend Hunter. It's more with more social trends that are going on. But the SpringWise is amazing. And we're talking about dry cleaners. How high tech can dry cleaners get? We're talking about innovation. For different products and service. So I had a client that we wanted to open up a dry cleaner. At that time, down in San Francisco, a dry cleaner was opening up a new service that he was putting lockers into condos so that tenants would pick up their dry cleaning from the lockers on their way to work and pick it up on their way home. So tweaking traditional business is called innovation, folks, staying competitive in this marketplace. And I guess I'm out of time. That's it. A little bit, yeah. It's based on tax returns, both T1 and T2 tax returns. So it's by province, by NAICS code, and it provides averages in thousands of dollars of what the average business is doing. And in my business, I get to see a lot of financial statements of small business, and it's scary. It's not the big dream world that we're talking about small business, because that doesn't really sell much. They're averages. Yeah. And can we go to one more? Let's see here. Yeah, that's okay. And so I'm on Insights, LinkedIn, and I've got a blog of market research around BC that I provide some do's and don'ts about what's going on with market research. Yeah.
I Googled the Site 5, like you mentioned, and it redirected to Prism 5.
Oh, Prism 5, sorry, yeah. Prism, yeah. The site was a previous generation of the Prism. Yeah, yeah, you're right, sir. Thanks for pointing that out. It's scary, though, huh? When you think, if you know your neighborhood, if you don't know your neighborhood, then you can't tell. But if you're out walking about, then yeah, it's pretty scary. Any other questions? There's so many. I know. I spend days in my seminars talking about this stuff, so it's pretty tough in half an hour to talk about it. I'd love to delve into it and show you how to benefit from it, but I just don't have time.
For marketing, what good website you go to check the product, is that good PV or not? Is that spy product.com.org?
There are software platforms out there like Snafu. Snafu is a Google-based platform. Anybody use Snafu? Snafu is a Google-based platform that will help you look at keywords that people are getting conversions off of, keywords for their website. That's a success rate. But in terms of actual products, Snafu, you got me. You
can,
yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Snafu. Any other questions?
What do you think the market, which market, global, is more reliable? China, US?
None. Really, the states right now.
Yeah.
The states right now. And that's a relative statement, right? That's a relative statement. Yeah. Yeah. That's about it.
One expressive shot of you expressing yourself with your just, yeah. And look over here. Look
no
over here.
Time!
Okay.
Thanks. No time. So, anyways, that's about it. That's all I've got. Well, that's all I'm going to give you today. Unfortunately. But yeah, there's lots of stuff. Thanks, guys. Thanks. Good luck. Good luck with your stuff.
I just want to say one thing.
Yeah.
He has a very good course.
There you go. Thanks, Richard.
You should go and look it up.
Thanks, Richard. Right on. Yeah, that's right on.
Market research.
It was so funny that time, too. I had an MSc in an engineer and engineer in industrial engineering. In that course.
Yeah.
And he came in and he looked like he knew it all. But he was a guy that was asking the most questions.
Yeah.
When things got good, right? So, yeah, no, it's a great course. What we do is you bring your devices in and you take home stuff. You will already start practicing in the seminar. It's not a passive. You bring your devices in the morning, we go through some definitions and I show you how to use the databases. In the afternoon, you can get down and dirty. Get into the databases and start looking for stuff. Especially in IBIS as well. It's an expensive database.
Any information is available there? Any fraud?
No.
Anything?
No, that's a great point. Each database is going to have its strength. So you're not going to go, all the databases are not the same. Each database is going to be quite different. Some may focus on wholesalers and manufacturers agents. Another may focus on general trends. Another may focus on the technical stuff. It really depends on what you're doing and which database you're going to for sure. Great. Okay. So that's it. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right, so we're going to start the Roadies Choice Awards, and the first one up is Talentful.
Should we start now, or?
A little bit away, that's it, but right there, it's fine.
Okay. Am I ready?
Yeah.
All right. So today, the recruiting of software developers has to be disrupted. It's costing way too much, taking too long, involving way too much labor. And today's existing practice cannot warrant the quality of hire. We solve all these problems by leveraging machine learning and billions of records of data from sites such as GitHub, Meetup, and Stack Overflow. We use this data to extrapolate individuals' professional strengths as well as personal passion. We combine all this data into a resume or machine-readable resume that's much richer and more in-depth than any existing resume format. And we're able to match instantly and accurately with very specific job requirements. Result is stunning. So far, we have cut down the 14 days of time to shortlist talents to less than a second, and thousands of dollars of cost, less than $500, and 80 hours of labor work, less than 1 hour. And above all, we can guarantee and warrant the quality of our talent recommendations. So with all that, be more than happy to talk to you afterwards.
Hold on. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, there we go.
The Donald Trump shot?
Yeah. Just
well, hand. My hand is too big, probably.
No, that's okay. Just put it out there.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
Get out of here.
All right. Good luck.
Hi, everybody. I'm Sarah. Did you? Okay. Okay, so heart disease is the leading cause of death in North America, killing 17 million people and more per year. But 80% of heart disease can be prevented. But how do we quantify how our lifestyle choices are having an effect on preventing heart disease? So I'd like to introduce iHeart. iHeart is a fingertip device and mobile app that helps that determines your internal age by measuring a scientifically proven heart health metric called aortic stiffness. The stiffness of your aorta, which is the biggest blood vessel in your body, has been proven to be not only a marker of heart health, but a marker of risk of death from all causes. The cool thing about iHeart is that changes can be seen quite quickly, so which provides more motivation for people to keep doing what they're doing to help prevent disease in the future. With regular testing and positive choices, people can work to lower their internal age, improving their health, and increasing their lifespan. Okay. You missed it! Twice! You only get two! One more? Thank you. There you go.
Thank you.
You got a top high kick.
Oh, it was awesome. I'm not kicking anything. Hi, everybody. How you guys doing? What? Yes?
Just a little bit off. That's good. So you're not being, you don't have a...
I can't see it. Hi, guys. I'm with CopyPants, and what we're doing is we're automating copyright protection for photographers. So basically, you all probably know a photographer who's had their images online being used without their permission. What we're doing is we're finding where all those copies are, and we're notifying them, and we're putting them two clicks away from being able to get paid for it, being able to protect their work, and being able to get credit for their work. And so our business model is pretty simple. We charge the photographers to be able to protect their work. On top of that, for the photographers who don't want to pay, like the people on Instagram, we basically help them monetize their work, and we take a cut of it. And yeah, that's CopyPants. We're awesome. We're going to take over the world.
Good job, man. Good job. Hello? Hi, my name is David. I'm part of the founding team of TalkTech. We are creating smart home sensors for seniors to help them to live at home independently and safely. The future of healthcare will transition from institutional and acute care to home and community care, and we hope to be part of that because not everyone can afford a private retirement home or home care services. So we hope to create something for our own parents so they can age in place safely. safely and happily. And our first product is concerning with the cooking sensor. Helps people to avoid cooking fires because unattended cooking is responsible for 34% of cooking fires at home, and seniors are twice more likely to suffer or get injured from cooking fires. So our sensor will attach to the kitchen stove, basically will alert the seniors whenever they forget to turn off fire. So thank you very much.
Is this already on?
Just turn off the light.
Hi, everyone. Sorry. My name is Kevin. I'm representing Modulator. We're making a communication module for Project Aura's modular cell phone platform, basically bringing walkie-talkies into the digital age. They'll attach to your cell phone. It's effectively a frequency-hopping, secure, encrypted walkie-talkie for your cell phone. Think of the times you've been in Las Vegas trying to text your friend, and it cost you $2 to find him in a casino, and he was right over there. No more $2. Any industries where you need to have secure communications that you don't want going over any networks where there's a security vulnerabilities or anything like that, it's just direct communication, also with the option of connecting to common IoT device protocols such as Zigbee and other more common 900 megahertz ISM band frequencies.
Hello?
Oh, perfect. What would our world look like if every child had access to basic education? At Change Heroes, that's the question that drives us at Change Heroes. It's the reason why we exist. At Change Heroes, we're on a social mission to one day see a world where every child has access to basic education. According to the UN, there are over 130 million children who don't have access to education. It's a big challenge, but it's a problem we believe that we can solve over the next 10 years. The way we're solving this problem is we built an online fundraising platform that makes it really easy for anyone to raise $10,000 to build a school or a library in a developing country. And the way it works, really simple. You make a list of 33 friends, record them each a 30-second personal video, and you send out those videos via email or Facebook. When your friends receive that video, they're asked to donate $3.33 a day for 3 months, the price of a cup of coffee. When 33 friends do that, it adds up to $10,000 and fully funds a school. Once school is funded, we send you photo updates of your school being built, and the best part is you can actually go on a trip and see the school that you funded. To date, we've funded over 150 schools, and now we've opened up our platform to other charities and Fortune 500 companies to use. Thank you.
Can I get one shot of you there? A little bit of expression. Great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. Hi, my name is Ronan O'Neill, and the company is Totix. We want to digitally scan and 3D print custom ankle foot orthotics for kids with disabilities. The current system takes too long, the products don't fit that well, and we want to take advantage of the developments in the industries. This is what is currently made. Please help us make something like this, something that's light, that fits better, less Velcro, and more functional. Thank you very much.
Can you hold those
on? Sure. Wait till I hold them nicely.
Not in front of your face.
No.
Thank you.
Hello, hello, guys. My name is Christopher, and I'm part of... Here. Okay. Okay. My name is Christopher, and I'm part of Spare Rides. We're out to solve commuting. Right now, in North America, there's over 77 billion commuter trips happening every year. And it's kind of funny how 85% of those are all single occupancy vehicles driving around. This is set for massive change. There's solid data right now that in the next 25 years, there's going to be over 50% of us using some form of shared mobility of getting to our work and to our home. and that's what we're here to solve. We right now have an actual live product in the App Store. You can download it right now. It's called Spare Rides, and it's a commute sharing platform specifically tailored for Vancouver. We're just running our pilot now in the UBC Broadway corridor, and then we're expanding to the rest of Vancouver later this summer. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mark Clancy, Water Cooler Analytics. Based on your ages, some of you may remember buying CDs in stores or even vinyl records. What we're trying to do is create that seamless iTunes experience that Apple created for music with market research data. Market research data is a $40 billion market, and we are now in revenue. We've got an MRR, monthly recurring revenue, of $17,000 a month. We've got some marquee clients like Visit Pittsburgh, Meet Minneapolis, Calgary Stampede, and we want to grow, and that's why we're here and here to learn. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Michael. We can start? No? Okay. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Michael Vogel. This is my brother, Dominic. We are the Bitcoin brothers behind Netcoins, which is a local Bitcoin startup. Now, for those of you not familiar, Bitcoin was actually the top performing currency of 2015, up 30%, up 3,000% over the past 3 years. Now, despite this popularity, it's actually excruciatingly difficult to buy Bitcoin, which is where we come in. We've created a virtual Bitcoin ETM that allows every retailer to sell Bitcoin without these five barriers to entry that exist that prevent a retailer from selling Bitcoin.
So real quickly about current traction. So we're in 17 stores across Canada right now. We're partnering with Gateway Newsstands, which has 500 stores across North America. And basically by the end of May of this year, we're going to be in Australia and in the UK and Ireland, which is going to enable us to scale to 7,000 plus locations. And that's more than 6,000 than we had anticipated for this year. So that's pretty much it. Hold for photo. There we go.
Okay, thanks, good. Guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, hello. My name is Alex Harmson, running Iris Automation. We're building computer vision collision avoidance systems for industrial drones. And we have seen the drone space just explode in the last couple of years. A lot of that focus has been on the military side of things, on the consumer side of things, photography. This sort of sector, there's a huge opportunity for industrial drone use, a huge opportunity for mining exploration, pipeline inspection, agricultural surveys, forest fire management, search and rescue, this sort of thing. But currently, we don't trust these systems to operate completely autonomously beyond line of sight to do these sort of 100-kilometer flights. And so at Iris Automation, we're building these collision avoidance systems for these industrial drones to really enable and unlock this huge market opportunity. So we've assembled a really awesome team of computer vision experts, people involved in the drone industry before, software developers, to really tackle this problem. And it's been super exciting so far. Up to this point, we've developed really this prototype. We're flying on board some development partners, and there's some really interesting opportunities ahead. Thanks.
Hello. I'm Chad Brown from Orange Docs, and we're looking to revolutionize how you're sharing market material with your customers. So currently today, when you have a high-value customer, you're looking to connect with them, you're looking to send them things such as like case studies, white papers, and whatnot. Usually it's done by sending an attachment via an email, and that really process hasn't changed since the 90s. We're looking to revolutionize that by providing something that's very visually engaging with your customers so they actually want to read it and explore it, and number two, to be able to actually understand what they're actually doing with it so you can track that to find out who is engaged and actually who are the high-value prospects there. We've ran an MVP for the last year or so and get a whole bunch of traction there, and if you're interested, please come talk to me, and I'm the last pitcher, so you're done.
do another post there as well? Or?
All right, you guys, so we ask that you text your choice to the phone number above, and we're going to see the audience's favorite pitch of the day. So go for it. Text away. All right, you guys, so the votes are in for the Roadies Choice Awards, and we'd like to call up Vital Signs. Good job. We'd like to take a picture. Thanks. What? Oh, thanks.
amazing. Thanks.
Congratulations.
Thanks, everyone. That's it.
Hi, everyone. So I hope you enjoyed your day. Who here enjoyed, had a very, you know, inspiring day? Come on, guys. So I'd like to actually announce the winner. We're just going to change the slide right here. So we've seen great pitches, and thank you all for making this possible for us. Thank you for Small Business BC and our national partners. Thank you to all the funders and entrepreneurs and volunteers that have come making this day as successful as it could be. Without further ado, I'd like to announce the sixth winner of our Fundica Roadshow Edition 2016 that will take home the prizes. So the package includes a round-trip airfare to San Francisco, 3 months office space in the Valley. They'll also get to pitch to VCs in San Francisco, as well as 1 free year of QuickBooks Online for your books, because you need to have them proper when you're raising funding, and a mega cloud hosting package by Canary and IBM. So without further ado, drum rolls. The winner for the 2016 Fundica Roadshow in Small Business BC Vancouver is Spare Rides. Congratulations. Congratulations.
Do we bring this home?
Oh. I would give it to you, but I can't. So what are you going to do in San Francisco?
I guess we're going to make our system work in San Francisco.
Right. Any words? Any words to aspiring entrepreneurs?
Don't be afraid to just try it. You have no clue how far you can get by just trying.
Okay. Well, thank you. And thank you all for coming again. We have a networking event, so...
Yeah, hi guys. Just when you thought this is the last pitch of the day, actually this is the last pitch, but it'd be really, really quick. We've got a networking and drinks event taking place at the Profile, which is in 375 Water Street, which is just straight across the car park. And sorry, parking lot. So you'd have to look at Translate. So it's on the second floor, and complimentary drinks and a chance to sort of unwind and sort of chat about today's findings. And hopefully we'll see you there. If you're not sure where it is, follow me.
All right. So thanks again, everyone, and hope you enjoy your day. Thanks.
Hello.
So yeah, this is just. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Hold the stand behind your trophy.
Okay.
That's perfect. And then I know. So this is just to highlight you. So I just want to know, tell me your experience, and if you, this is your first funding project, and if you would, how many times you pitched before? Are you a seasoned pitcher or not? And if you would recommend it to
us? Okay.
Just the process and your impressions.
Of today.
Yeah, of today.
Okay. So. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. So today been a really amazing experience. I'm super happy to be here at the Fundica Roadshow event. Had a great experience trying out some new pitch strategies and just seeing all of the awesome other companies that are here in Canada and here in Vancouver. Really happy to get the opportunity to present. I really think that if you really want to do something, and if you have an idea, you should just do it, because it's only you that's stopping it from happening.